и релаксиращ обяд. Надявам се да все пак да сте се заредили с много енергия, защото ни предстоят още много предизвикателни теми. Аз ще изчакам хората отзад да намерят своите места. Имаме време, деня пред нас. Добре, ориентирахме се. Добре, в следващите минути ще попитаме какви технологии и компании има на Балканите. До сега говорихме за България и България в Европа и Европа като цяло. Сега да видим какво се случва в околностите на България и какво можем да направим заедно. Както вече сте видяли, в програмата следващите гости са доста високи топки. И без да се мутаем, първият ни гост, мисля, че можем да го анонсираме. Това е основателят и редактор на издание, което точно вие, хората, които сме се събрали тук, няма как да не знаете. Tech.eu. Той ще ни опише нагледно колко е важна ролята на мрежите за развитието на екосистеми. Дами и господа, Иво Шпигел.
Good afternoon. I guess you've all been to biz conferences before. So if you've been, you know that the hardest, toughest slots are the one before lunch, when the speaker is between you and your food, and the one after lunch, when your brain cells are busy doing something else and paying attention. So I thought I'd put up a little bit of a provocative slide just to kick us off. We talked about the content of my talk, and agreed with the organizers that I would kind of stream it a little bit in a different direction and essentially talk a bit about Europe and what's happening with European tech. As our MC mentioned, I'm one of the co-founders of TechEU. TechEU is basically, so how many people have ever heard of TechEU? Okay, great, fantastic, thank you. For those who don't know, it's an online publication essentially covering technology companies and technology trends throughout Europe. We try to cover them in more detail, in more long form, than the usual short blog posts on most tech publications. And we try to go all over Europe. We try to find interesting companies, interesting events, and things going on throughout Europe. So a few years ago, I wrote a little piece about the Bulgarian startup ecosystem. A few months ago, I was in Tallinn in Estonia. And I'm originally from Zagreb, Croatia, where I'm based. And it's great to be back in Sofia. I want to thank the organizers for inviting me, congratulate for a very interesting conference, and also thank them for this wonderful weather, lovely weather that we're having for the conference itself. So, who knows what happened on January 9th, 2001 in technology? Okay, I'll skip to the answer immediately. iTunes was launched. So iTunes, as I'm sure all of you know, was a breakthrough event for digital music. Until then, there was piracy, there was Napster, but there wasn't really a way to enjoy digital music that was legally licensed and where you could buy song by song instead of just having to buy the whole crappy album because of that one hit. So it was a really revolution in the way we enjoyed and music and in our digital entertainment. Now, if you go back and think about iTunes, those of you that were already, you know, growing up at the time, there was a device that went with it. It was called iPod. So today, we remember iPods as something our grandparents used a long, long time ago. So who listens to music on their iPod today? Okay, still a few veterans out there, good to see. Most of us, however, use one of these. So how many people use Spotify? Okay, Deezer, okay. Last.fm, bit older generation, SoundCloud. So, you know, we used to download music to our devices. We don't do that anymore, or at least very little. Now we use streaming. So streaming is the way most people consume digital music today. And if you look at the reports, they say that finally artists and composers are getting more and more money directly from their music being played on the streaming services. So aside from all of these being streaming music services, what else do all of these companies have in common? That's right, they're European companies. So when Apple came up with iTunes and iPod, essentially Americans took over digital music, and now we Europeans took it back. Thank you to Daniel Ek and the other great founders of these companies. So if you look at digital music today, the space is owned by European companies. And this is not a coincidence, and it's not just kind of a freak event. To me, this symbolizes the rise of European tech. And this is one of the things that motivated us to build TechU way back in 2013, is that European tech is becoming more and more, I wouldn't say dominant, but at least on an equal footing with our friends and colleagues and competitors from the US and from Asia. It's not just music. Europe is being very, very strong and playing a very, very competitive game in a number of areas. Fintech, gaming, especially mobile gaming, and I could go on and on in different sectors. At TechU, besides writing about startups and founders, we also do reports. So my friends in our team do reports on what's happening in Europe, especially particularly in funding. So if you go to the TechU site, you will find reports on European funding in, I don't know, Q1, Q2, Q3, and then all of 2016, 2017. So here we have just a few numbers put up on the board talking about how we're doing in Europe. So Q3 of 2017 was the best quarter on record ever for investments, for VCs, and for funding in Europe. Exits were very strong in 2016. We expect more of those and with more and bigger numbers in 2017. And if you follow the tech publications, you will know that more and more funds are coming online and bigger amounts are being raised. So when you look at Europe today, Sofia, Zagreb, Ljubljana, Tallinn, Paris, London, it's nothing like it was 5, 6, 7, or even 10 years ago. The opportunities for entrepreneurs, as our colleague from Google mentioned, and who's completely right, are way better than they used to be. Funding, co-working spaces, mentorship, education. So entrepreneurs today have opportunities like their friends and colleagues never had 4 or 5 years ago or 10 years ago. The downside is that it's easier than ever to get into a tech, to get into entrepreneurship, so the competition is bigger. But hey, if you're good and if you're a winner, you don't care about that too much. Who plays online games? I don't, but my son does. Okay, who knows this game? World of Tanks? Okay. Who knows where this company is headquartered? Belarus, Minsk. So Minsk, the capital of Belarus. I've never been to Belarus. I don't have this huge desire to go. But if you ask most people in the gaming community, they wouldn't know, except for the few people that are here that do know. But it's an example of a European company dominating the world scene in their particular niche. So this guy, I'm sure everybody from Belgrade and Serbia recognizes the guy on the right-hand side. So the company is called Nordius, and the game they're building is called Top 11. It's a world-dominating game in football management, online football management on your mobile phone. So these guys built this thing in Belgrade. So it's not London, it's not a high-tech hub, at least it's not recognized by the media as one. Probably one of the most unlikely places to build a super successful, bootstrapped digital company. And when you talk to Branko, who is the founder and CEO, he will tell you that they couldn't have built it anywhere else. Why? Because their HR strategy of himself and his co-founders is based on their network. So the original people that formed around the three co-founders, the key team, are all of their friends from university and the people that they know and trust. And then around that team, they build a company that today has, I don't know, 150, 200 people in Belgrade, offices in London, and I guess Skopje as well. So an amazing European success story, again, bootstrapped. So no external funding. And as Branko says, there probably isn't a VC in Europe that hasn't knocked on his door and sent him emails saying, you know, we'd like to invest in your company. But they were profitable from, they were cash positive 1 month after the launch of the product. It's an outlier. Supercell up in Helsinki, where I'm going next week, His company does also mobile gaming. Supercell was acquired first by the Japanese, then the Japanese sold them to the Chinese, but still they're based in Finland. Probably worth around, I guess, 3 or 4 billion euros as a company. They generate, last I checked, the company generates around $2 million of profit per day. So yes, we can build great companies in Europe. Prezi in Budapest, I'm sure many of you use those presentations where your head starts spinning, but nevertheless, a great tool for creatives. SoundCloud, two Swedes that went to Berlin to found their company. And we could go on and on. Outfit 7, Talking Tom, if you have small children, they're probably addicted. They sold it for €1 billion to the Chinese just a few months ago. Again, bootstrapped, no external funding. The founders and their team put all of that money in their pockets, so they have a lot of money going around now. Photomath out of Croatia, and of course Rimac Automobili, again, super fast car, supercar, electric, etc. So I could go on and on, but not too much, take your time. So there are many, many, many of these companies, many of which are not well known. Some of Europe's greatest tech successes are B2B companies. And if you're a B2B company, the general public doesn't know anything about you, and you don't need them to. But there are some amazing B2B companies in Europe. So the slide I opened with is actually a photo from a TransferWise marketing campaign. And the street that these nice, scantily clad ladies and gentlemen are in is actually Wall Street. So this is a marketing campaign to launch TransferWise on the US market. Before that, they were just in UK first, and in Europe, etc. And the point of this particular image is that they want transparency. They want to show how the banks have all these secret. They're kind of taking your money away, and TransferWise wants to be transparent. So that's why they have this politically incorrect marketing campaign. So preparing for this talk, and I'll go through this very quickly because we don't have that much time, I reached out to some of my friends in the startup and tech community to ask them a simple question. What should our policymakers, what should Mrs. Gabriel, who was here from the European Commission, what should her colleagues in Brussels and our national governments do to help our industry grow? And Herti Tamo from Estonia, so this is a very typical answer for an Estonian, make ICOs legal, which is, I'm sure, a very, very worthy cause. Stefan Glenzer, one of the co-founders of Last.fm, who is now a VC in London, more visas for techies. So from Stefan's view, and I'm sure from many of our perspectives, the talent issue is critical. We need more people, better educated. So all the efforts by Google and others to support that and to educate more tech people in our industry, digital leaders, is absolutely necessary, and we're going to have more and more need for those as the years are going by. Siim Sikkut, who is one of the people behind the e-residency program in Estonia, today he's the chief information officer for the government, just sent a single link, and if you get this presentation later, you can click on that link. It's a list of priorities that was created by digital leaders in Europe, just recently published during the Estonian presidency of the European Council, which is still ongoing. So he just sent a link to that list. This is a long slide, so I won't read the whole thing, but it's a very interesting guy. The guy is called Tom Wehmeyer. He's actually a partner in Atomico. Atomico is one of Europe's largest VC funds. It's based in London. I was just visiting them about 3 weeks ago. Their most recent fund raised early this year was 750 million euros. So there's 750 million euros targeted at European founders and high-tech entrepreneurs. And I won't read the whole thing, but I'll just start initially. So Tom says, I think the biggest shift in public policy is to move into offense mode and to start viewing regulation as an opportunity to derive competitive advantage at the country and regional level. So what he's saying here is that efforts to build connectivity, free Wi-Fi in parks and hospitals are okay, but actually this is a more ambitious proposal. This is a proposal where he expects our public policy leaders to take the initiative and to build regulation so that it really supports the strong growth and development of high tech. When I was visiting Estonia early July, I chatted with a government person about Uber. So just a few months before that, they had finally sorted out the regulatory issues around Uber, so Uber is now legal in Estonia. But at the same time, when they were figuring out how to make Uber legal, the same set of regulation regulated those little self-driving drones, if you see them. It's called Starship. So there's a company called Starship that has a little robot that has an antenna and it will deliver pizza to your door autonomously going along the sidewalk. So they included that in the regulation. It's just an example of very forward-looking policy creation. My colleague Robin Waters, our editor, they're doing some things right, they're doing some things wrong, but they need to communicate better between public policy and with entrepreneurs as well. Kristen Talawalski, VC, align regional and national year programs, hire former entrepreneurs and investors to run those programs, because very often they're much smarter about it than public officials. Again, one of my friends from TechU, push promoting and training people, again, this emphasis on training in AI machine learning. Max Kelly from Techstars London, who's actually in Sofia today for another event. Scaling companies need money, they need talent, they need customers. And finally, he says, on a separate note, stop Brexit. So it's not something for us to do, but obviously a huge concern. So what about our region? What about Southeast Europe or the West Balkans, depending on how you politically prefer it? Well, in my experience, our politicians, our policy makers and leaders are not really always up to speed when it comes to digital. They tend to be preoccupied with more kind of down-to-earth things, so we need to push them. We need to lobby, and it's great that we have this event today with some of them present here in the conference. But on the other hand, all of us in high tech and our entrepreneurs and startups live in a kind of world of their own. So if you go to Web Summit, or if you go to Slush, or you go to any conference in Europe, entrepreneurs have the same problems, whether they're from Sofia, Ljubljana, or Lisbon, or Berlin, or London. They're facing the same issues. How do I find my tech co-founder? How should I develop my programs? So they're living in this kind of similar world, and by and large, these companies can afford to be less dependent on local policy issues. So on the one hand, we who are a bit older need to push our policy leaders to make better policy, better decisions. On the other hand, we need to encourage our entrepreneurs not to be so dependent or even worry too much about local legislation and regulatory issues, because they're all part of a global world and are addressing the global market. So quick plug, this is a book I wrote a few years ago with interviewing many of European startups, some of whom were listed here during the presentation. You can look it up on Amazon, and some have said that it's a good read. It's time for European startups to be awesome, to just go out and continue crushing and winning, and I think we have every kind of, all of the stuff we need to continue doing that. And with that, I want to thank you for your attention. I guess we have a panel now. My name is Ivo Spiegel. You can find me on Twitter and on TechU and here at the conference as well. Thank you. I was okay with time, I hope. Time was okay. Do I keep this?
Yes, you can.
Okay.
But first to say thank you, Ivo, for the great... great talk. Switching to Bulgarian again.
Thank you.
Имаме ли време за въпроси? Във вашия. Окей, значи панела след това той влиза, така че там могат да се дават въпроси. Окей. Нещо интересно, TechU са всъщност едно от първите издания, които започват да правят някакъв доста по-дълбок анализ на цялата европейска стартъп екосистема и на инвестициите, които влизат в стартъп компании като цяло. Така че перспективата, която той вкарва и дава, е доста интересна и със сигурност много полезна. Всъщност, за да продължим този разговор, бих искал да поканя ко-директорът на Founders Institute България, Жанет Тодорова, която ще попита своите интересни гости. Как работим заедно за дигитален хъб в малко по-голямата регионална картинка? Нека тя представи своите гости. Аплодисменти за Жанет.
Благодаря. I think I will switch in English because it will be easier with my peers to have a fluent conversation. So, first of all, I just want to have a brief introduction regarding this panel. So it was really important for us to find key influencers on the Balkans and actually have a very relevant point of view on what's happening in other Balkan countries and kind of see what are our common challenges small successes and how can we move forward to collaborate together. So for this, first of all, I want to thank Filip Stojanovic, who actually helped us reach out to the right people, and also Max Gurwitz, who is unfortunately not here, but he will join soon. Some other events. So first I would like to invite on stage Vele Samak, who is a former Minister for Foreign Investments in Macedonia. Please. I would first like to apologize if I don't pronounce the name correctly, please. So Grigoris Hadji Kostas.
Perfect.
Yeah. He's head of business development at Bioscience Institute in Serbia. Then Ivo, you already met him on stage, Ivo Spiegel. And Miloš Lazović, who is an ecosystem facilitator, currently active in four ecosystems from the Balkans, so Albania, Macedonia, Serbia, Bosnia and Herzegovina, so please. Before we start, I would like to invite you to post your questions, because in the end we will leave some time for answers. Also, I'd like to do the startup thing, which is a selfie. Cool, thanks. So, I suggest we start with a brief introduction. So, what is the ecosystem that you're coming from doing? What is the latest development? Each one of you has a different perspective. So, just to get on the same page here, all of us, would you like to start with a brief intro?
From the end? Okay, so I'm, as you heard, Miloš Lazović. I'm working on a Swiss entrepreneurship program. It's a regional program present in four countries in the Balkans. So, as Jeanette said, Serbia, Bosnia and Herzegovina, Albania and Macedonia. My team concretely works on Serbia and Bosnia, but I'm also familiar with happenings in two other countries. We are a support program in a sense that we support organizations which support entrepreneurs, but we also work with startups themselves very often, and our experts, aside from working on developing these acceleration and similar programs, also do different kinds of workshops, one-on-one mentorings, group mentorings, Q&A sessions, different kinds of specific events. In our case, these four countries we're present in are in very similar. I mean, everybody has a different opinion about what's happening across the border, but in reality, all these countries are maybe 2 or 3 years apart. So what we are seeing is that all four of the countries usually have all the ingredients of well-developed ecosystems, but these ingredients are not always coordinated and interacting very well. Mm-hmm. In concretely in Serbia and Bosnia, the biggest lack of the proper, of most of the ingredients of this ecosystem is actually angel investing. Mm-hmm. And I think that in these four countries, we still didn't have this proper first generation of startups, which then turn mentors and angel investors. Mm-hmm. So this is a situation we are also trying to remedy now, because we are starting to hear that there are people popping up which are willing to invest and take part in the ecosystem. Of course, they are still pretty secretive. It's not very popular to have money to share in the Balkans. Yeah. So we're working on that now, but what we see is that infrastructure is starting to show up properly. There's accelerators now, there's some organizations which have their own funds now, so there's a bunch of everything, and we have different kinds of organizations in the last 3 years from that started as co-working spaces in most of the cases, but now are turning into full-blown commercial accelerators. So for the start.
Ivo, you have the experience of founding an incubator in Croatia, so maybe you can give us an idea what's happening over there.
Yeah, we started, it's called ZIP, and we founded that 5 years ago, actually, in spring of 2012. We just started with our 11th batch a few weeks ago. Croatia is, like all of Europe, advanced, like Bulgaria as well, advanced tremendously. Well, I would say advanced somewhat over the past times. When we started that in 2012, it was practically the only program. There were no co-working spaces, very little of anything else, no funding. So we didn't have a single VC at the time. We have one now that is also present in Serbia as well, so all of one VC. But as we all know, for talented founders, it's so much easier today to find funding elsewhere. So several Croatian startups came to Bulgaria to launch Haventu. and to 11. Some have been to German or British startup programs, Techstars UK. We have several alumni. So, you know, Airbnb, low-cost jets, Skype, cloud computing. So, like I said before, for Croatian, Bulgarian, other startups, if we don't have a local VC, we go elsewhere where there's money. So that's not, again, it's important to have local infrastructure, absolutely, because it makes things so much easier. And yes, now we have that. Now there are several programs, there are several co-working spaces, so the whole environment and the whole ecosystem is much better than it used to be. It could have been much, much better had our public officials been more receptive to the needs of the digital ecosystem and industry, but we are. It is what it is, as we would say that. So, and this kind of, you know, reflects all of Europe. If you look at what's happening in Paris now, my friend Roxanne Varza, who is also co-founder of TechU, is now the program director for Station F. I don't know how much you've seen this, but it's amazing. So they transformed the whole railway station, essentially, into a gigantic incubator, I guess 30, 40,000 square meters. And it's an amazing project that it's a fantastic example of collaboration between the private sector, which is Xavier Niel, who is the telecoms mogul in France, and the city of Paris, which worked with him to kind of restructure the whole surrounding area of the city in order to be able to kind of welcome entrepreneurs who want to come there. And everything there is in English. So, you know, if you know Paris and you know the French, and you know that something's happening totally in English there, then you know that something real is happening.
Yes.
Just a quick kind of comment on the perspective of Europe. I think Europe now has actually an amazing chance from an unhappy situation. In other words, if you look at what's happening in the US with the whole political situation, if you look at what's happening with Brexit, in a sense, continental Europe does have a chance to benefit from those developments. They're not very happy developments. We'd all much rather have our friends in the UK stay in the EU, but that's, you know, it was their decision and they're leaving. And I'm sure, you know, many, if you look at TransferWise, which I just mentioned earlier, they're totally based in the UK, although the two founders are Estonian, but they're very actively now looking to establish a strong base, a strong headquarters in continental Europe. To be able to maximize the use of talent, because nobody knows what's going to happen with the visas, with the traveling and all that. So things are developing, and it's up to all of us to take the advantage of that. Mm-hmm.
All right. Grigoris, you have the special case where you actually have an industry focus perspective on the ecosystem. So can you share a little bit more about your view on ecosystems?
Yes, well, that's true. Our perspective stands on two pillars. So on one hand, what we're doing is that we're using extensively European funding, cascade funding. So we use the European projects to issue open calls, to select companies, to try to offer them equity free funding along with support services, acceleration programs, in a way. But we specialize in one particular sector, and this is AgTech. And
probably explain what AgTech is.
Yes, that's true. So AgTech is an abbreviation for what we say advanced ICT for agriculture and food industry. So practically this might be things that have to do for helping farmers to produce more in the farm, things that applications that help the value chain work better and the supply chain work more effectively, or even applications that help and solutions that help the consumer make the right decisions with respect to food. Just to give you an overview of what some types of companies that we are funding. Some of the success stories in the region are, for example, Agrivi from Croatia that has been funded by our accelerator program Fractals. Also Dunavnet from Novi Sad, and also we have some very good companies other that managed to go to international markets, and we had lots of help from Philip and Max on this because we took some of our companies to the US and they started doing business there. And I think that things are quite positive in the sense that we see more and more because we, at the same time, while issuing these programs, we try to follow up what is happening in the other side of the Atlantic, and we try to follow up a little bit the venture capital activity all over the world with respect to these technologies. So yes, we do have successful exits. Of course, in the AgTech so far, in particular in Europe, successful exit doesn't mean IPO. Most of the times it means that some big agricultural company is taking over, but also something that I... of the discussion we had yesterday, and I picked up from your words, that we have many companies that start as startups, then they transform themselves into sustainable service offering companies. They don't scale up, they don't become IPO ready, but still they hire great people, they produce great solutions, and they solve lots of problems. And if at the end our reason of existence is to create good products and to do good business, mm-hmm. then I think that we're on the right path.
Okay, thanks. Vele, how about your point of view from a more government perspective?
Just as a point of interest, I spent the last 10 years in the government as a minister attracting foreign companies. So this was I take a very practitioner's approach in this aspect. And in the last six or so years, one of our pillars has been to promote innovation and entrepreneurship within the country. So I have the perspective both from sort of a top-down government bureaucratic approach of trying to encourage this, as well as a very practical approach, which is, you know, if you have a business in the startup and you have a particular challenge, what are all the steps you need to do to be successful? So what we have found the last few years is that many of the IT graduates, computer science graduates, are finding easily jobs inside Macedonia, and of course the first step in there is a typical outsourcing businesses, whether it's some of the foreign companies present or some of the newly created companies. But as the awareness of a lot of things that were mentioned in this panel is growing, the more interaction is growing, we're seeing actually companies trying to develop more original products. So they're still at a very early stage. It's less the case where capital is a big issue. It used to be in the past, but now it's more of, you know, there's an idea, it needs to be taken to fruition, to test it on the market and actually gain some traction, some monthly recurring revenue and things like that. So what we see now is some accelerators who are trying to help with this, more and more co-working spaces which are trying to appear, and we're seeing a lot more visitation by foreign entrepreneurs who are coming and spending some time to actually impart some of these skills and some of the advice in that process. Unfortunately, we do have the trend that, you know, it's also prevalent in other countries where good engineers find jobs abroad. So some of these efforts are also at trying to keep them in place, but with opportunities. Of course, you cannot keep people locally anymore. And from a public policy perspective, one of the avenues was to create a fund for information and technology transfer in the country. It's actually well funded. Unfortunately, whenever you have a very heavily bureaucratic mechanism, the funding process goes quite slowly. So far, about less than a million of or roughly 9 million fund has been dispersed. But the new director is actually quite optimistic to ratchet up this disbursements over the next few years. So this top-down effort, as well as a lot of the interaction among the engineers, some of the startups, is creating a lot of interest to actually create some of these businesses and grow abroad. So.
Can you give us an example of a successful initiative or project that actually had a positive impact on the startup ecosystem?
So in Macedonia, in the past, one of the companies created an application called SportyPal. So it might not be as known today when you have the likes of Nike, RunPlus, or Edmondo and others. So it was one of the first ones actually that started this trend of a mobile app to track sports activity. It gained some partnership and traction at the time with Sony Ericsson. So out of this startup, a few other outsourcing businesses came up. That was the unfortunate setup that it was not taken in the next phase and perhaps develop something more. But it did create a very visible example that, hey, you can actually grow a global consumer app business out of this out of Macedonia.
So something very typical that is happening right now in the Bulgarian ecosystem is that actually we're trying to find the focus. So similar to the agri-tech focus, here there are several initiatives that are running like a blockchain focus or a fintech focus. So I was wondering, can you share your experience? What works well in your ecosystems? Like whether it's let's find the focus or let's bring key stakeholders together, or what would be an approach that you see that works well?
Same order or?
As you prefer.
Well, in our case, obviously software is the first software, then everything that comes with the software. So we don't have that many successful hardware companies yet. There are some. Even the ones which are very good, usually the engineers are the founders, so yeah, they're a specific kind of people. I don't think we have any kind of focus, as you said, in our countries that I'm kind of representing here. So we really see everything. We have also, we talked previously about the blockchain. So we, as of recently, have weekly meetups related to blockchain. It's still a very small community, but it's a very attractive topic. So there's a lot of people popping up in that sector, not just developers, but also investors and people which are only curious about the financial aspect of it. Software as a service, of course. I'm not sure really. I mean, we have gaming startups also, which are doing very well. As Ivo said, Nordius is probably the best example from Serbia as a bigger startup. Mm-hmm. Two other big startups that we have, really, really big, probably not globally known, but in their sectors very specific, is Seven Bridges Genomics, which are basically based in US now. They developed a platform for some advanced tracking of genomes and specific DNA research, which is actually then offered to different kinds of institutions which deal with genetics across the world, and they're actually being featured on VentureBeat recently. Third one is The Frame, which was kind of acquired by some other organization. I'm not really sure if they just invested or acquired. So they're doing cloud computing, where you can sit by a cheap laptop and actually use a very advanced hardware. So these are three really big ones in three different sectors.
If you see these stories, is there a common pattern? Like, what works well?
The most common pattern is maybe not vertical oriented, but almost all of these startups which start are bootstrapped for a really long while.
Okay.
So this is what probably prevents some verticals to be more developed, which need initial financing, but that's maybe one common thing, because a lot of startups bootstrap for a really long while based on, I don't know what, I mean, some of them have like family money or three Fs, you know, friends, fools, and
Family,
yeah. So that's, I think that's common for all of them. So.
Mm-hmm. How about from your perspective?
Well, from my perspective, my experience, I don't think there's any kind of simple rules or formula that you can kind of put together in an ecosystem and say this is what works. The successes we've had in Croatia, I mentioned Photomath and their sister company PhotoPay, so they're doing both very different areas, but based on common technology. Rimac is, for me, a very interesting case for several reasons, but one of the reasons is that actually it's a car company, super advanced, high-tech, fastest electric car in the world, and Croatia is probably the country in this region with absolutely the least car technology heritage. So, you know, even in former Yugoslavia, each republic had some car factory. So in Slovenia they had Renault, in Sarajevo they had TAS, in Serbia they had a Fiat, obviously, etc. Croatia was the only one without a car factory. So absolutely zero heritage industrial in that area, but nevertheless some guy comes in and becomes a global leader actually in that field. To me, that's just an indicator that it's really hard to rely, or especially to bet on any particular sector. In Croatia, definitely, it's very, very widely dispersed. So we have Belabit, who are doing wearable IoT for health. We have PhotoPay in educational, a few others. I think basically the role of the public, of the policymakers, is to create a very, very general infrastructure. Mm-hmm. So to create the environment. Both ensuring finance, securing educational opportunities. In the long term, I would say that the biggest responsibility of the government and the public sector is education. So we talked a little bit yesterday about Silicon Valley and could there be a European Silicon Valley, etc. One thing that, you know, one key element of Silicon Valley that is often, because people talk about diversity and people, immigrants coming and talent and etc., etc., but there is Stanford. So there is this super strong, globally leading university in the middle of that whole thing. And if I look at universities, I mean, I don't know that much about, I mean, you know, we often pitch this region as technical talent. I know certainly Zagreb University produces okay engineers. Okay, so my son is studying mathematics at Zagreb University, and I'm happy about that because math is math wherever you study. But unfortunately, if you look at the number of foreign students in Zagreb, in Croatian universities, it's around 2 or 3%, so zero basically. If you come to Zagreb University, any of the faculties, even my own, electrical computer engineering, you will only hear Croatian in the halls. You will only see white people there. So there are no black people, there are no people from Asia. Nobody's coming to Croatia because we talk about brain drain and we are losing our engineers. And I always say to that discussion, I always say that's bullshit. Because people from everywhere go to other places, from Switzerland to US, from the US to France, from France to other places. The difference with Croatia is that people are going as well, like from everywhere else, but nobody is coming there, or at least very few are coming. And if they're coming, they're not coming to the university. They're coming, there is, for instance, a very interesting fintech startup founded by four guys, none of which is from Croatia. Their market is in Africa and Asia. They're doing microfinance, cloud computing, blah, blah, blah. They established the company in Zagreb because when they calculated the cost of living, the nice environment, EU membership, time zone similarity to Africa, they kind of did the calculation, and one of them had Croatian roots. So that's why they established in Zagreb. But in general, to come back to the topic of education, education is super important. I was speaking with a guy from Atomico a few weeks ago, again, about these centers in Europe. And he also said, you know, of course, every country is, you know, building their education system to attract talent. And I was thinking in my head, yeah, except Croatia, of course. But nevertheless, huge responsibility to our leaders is to build world-class educational system, world-class universities. So people will come to Sofia, to Belgrade, to Zagreb, to study because there are some amazing professors doing cutting-edge research work in some of these areas, blockchain, AI, et cetera, et cetera. I think we have, in Croatia, we have, unfortunately, none of that. I don't know that much about Bulgaria, don't know so much, but in general, my impression is that we produce solid technical talent, but our universities are not magnets pulling in people from all over the world to come to Sofia instead of, I don't know, ETH Zurich or EFPL in Lausanne. So, and that's where the students come in, that's where diversity is generated, ideas pool, and this is one of the success factors for globally leading companies.
I think you're already answering my second question.
Sorry.
But maybe you too, if you would like to add something.
Yes, no, you cannot find patterns, but I think you can find some connecting tissue in the unicorns, leocorns, however you want to call them. And this is mostly like being able to identify or create an unfair advantage and then being able to exploit it all the way. Let me give a very brief example from our neighborhood, from Novi Sad, where you had a company that was the typical case of a startup, but a little bit before the term was invented. And in this time where Serbia was under isolation, they had the chance to be the only ICT provider for the electrical grid network. And this company managed to grow impressively. It was acquired by Schneider Electric, and now it has the software of management of electric grid in more or less like maybe 40% of the world. So
and
this is in
1,000 people or something.
Yes. And putting challenge all the other software development companies because they're the big elephant in the room. But the point is that they managed to create an unfair advantage for themselves under very challenging conditions, I would say. And maybe this is the path to see because another successful company, totally different model, is these guys from Apex. The founders are 27 or 20 years old each, I think, or something like that. More artistic, and they're into the gaming industry. They pivoted already twice, but still surviving and still growing, and you can still see lots of young programmers over there finding some niche market in the US gaming industry. So you see, there are people who can find unfair advantages and exploit them. That, I think that's the way we should look at it. Above patterns and above, it's not easy to say. I mean, the ACTEC for some reasons, but I don't believe that. I wouldn't look at the audience and say, everybody go for ACTEC and only for ACTEC. No, it doesn't work like that. So there are reasons that people are successful in what they're doing, and that's, I think, the only sort of pattern I can see.
So I just wanted to add in onto what Eva's point about the universities being a magnet. One of the issues that we saw as one of the policy drivers that we have to put in is that if you look at this region, and I don't want to quote numbers off the top of my head, the R&D percentages are so minimal, they're literally abysmal. And it's one avenue where governments can have a huge impact, and which is throw actual money, I was going to say dollars, but throw actual money at the universities for R&D. It is a core of what creates sort of a sustainable long-term advantage to have the kind of both professors, but also graduate students and engineers and in many different fields to kind of stick around and look for something new, out of which you can expect a long wave of commercialization in the future. It's not just having an engineer who will do a lot of coding and be helped with some design and maybe hire some salespeople after a while. So that can create good brands, but the sustainability innovation has to come from that avenue. And the other aspect is also a little what was mentioned a little earlier today, which is the training aspect. In Macedonia, we're just now touching on reinvigorating this dual education system that we used to have in former Yugoslavia, but the driver behind that is mostly around manufacturers, because they need skilled, trained machine operators. It's no longer just manual labor, it's machine operators. But I think the same avenue will catch up on in the IT, where you need some well-qualified either programmers or IT engineers who don't necessarily have to have an engineering diploma, but who will be able to do a lot of the work, whereas more senior, more advanced level graduates and engineers, those are the ones who will do the architecting. And that's a critical component if you want to have a lot more original IP here. We looked at these issues, and as always with public policy, sometimes it's a hit and miss. So some things we try to approach the right way, some things, if you lack practical experience, you really don't see how you could move the needle on some of these things. But the good part is that I see a lot of activity in Macedonia trying to actually be open about trying to create new products and new services. There isn't one sector or formula or other. There is a particular challenge in addressing an enterprise segment, just simply because the country is too small and the access to enterprises who would buy into new software is not that readily available. So that's why consumer type of work has a little higher chance at this point. At least that's what we've been seeing so far in the last few years.
So. Mm-hmm. So I think all the Balkan countries, I have this feeling from what we share that we have similar successes, like the pattern, tech talent and so on, but also similar challenges. And I think it's clear from what was even announced today by the Commissioner Gabriel that there is going to be a collaboration on the Balkans. So from your perspective, can you share your view? What is going to happen in the next 5 years? How are we going to collaborate between each other, the Balkans? Me, it could be wishful thinking also.
5 years is a lot of time. I mean, I'll give you a little example. My project was developed in 2013, mm-hmm. and before it started implementing in 2015, it was already obsolete. So in 2 years, a lot of things changed. So 2 or 3 years ago, we didn't have accelerators, we didn't have hubs, we didn't have successful startups, mm-hmm. we didn't have mentors. So this is only 2 or 3 years. So if wishful thinking, yeah, maybe... more specifically for this, each of the ecosystems, I hope that we actually do get angel investors and that we get more mentors which are professional and can help the startups. But on the other hand, we are now talking about different ecosystems, and in 5 years, I really hope that we can talk about one ecosystem in the Balkans or maybe even Southeastern Europe or something like that. I know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So
I'm a dreamer, so.
Yes, of course. Okay.
Yeah, well... I think obviously regional cooperation is important and there needs to be more of it, and communication events like this one. Mm-hmm. But I think my personal view is that we have to kind of coordinate and work together much more closely on a pan-European level. Mm-hmm. So the Nordics have their own thing, we have some specifics here, et cetera, et cetera. But essentially, you know, from my perspective, the game is Asia, US, Europe. And Africa is also becoming much, much stronger, and very interesting things are happening there. But I think, you know, we have to think and act like Europeans, regardless of formal membership or not membership, because obviously so many programs are available and communication is happening and all that. I don't think it's going to be a single ecosystem, actually. I think there always will be multiple ecosystems. The question is how well can they be coordinated? So it's always going to, I mean, because, you know, life and business is digital to a degree, but to a degree it's physical. So you're living in Sofia, he's living in Belgrade, I'm living in Zagreb, and, you know, that's the place where we actually do our business, regardless of where our customers are. So these ecosystems are going to continue to be city-based ecosystems, actually, more than country-based. And absolutely we need to, you know, talk and communicate more. We need to have common initiatives towards the public policy creators, and a lot of that needs to be on a pan-European level, to, you know, to push for initiatives which are tearing down, because there's still many. I mean, even EU formally is a single market, but in real practice, as we talked today multiple times in the conference, if you need to hire a guy from here to there, if you need to move physically there, what's happening with your data, with your stuff, etc., tax, not even to mention the issue of tax, VAT, etc. So there's there are a lot of huge obstacles remaining. Thank God, at least in EU, we got rid of roaming, because that was kind of bizarre. And obviously, any initiative to bring that down in the region as well is great. But coming back to what Vele said, academia, university, research is really super important. And I see, I'm sure there are also key. I mean, if we can just have all of our entrepreneurs push our governments to increase R&D spending, which is very, very low in all of the countries. And, you know, in Croatia right now, every day in the newspapers, we are supposed to buy some new fighter jets for Croatia. So to me, I don't know whether to laugh or to cry, because it's kind of tragicomical. I was, you know, again, I will take the example of Estonia. They don't have any fighter jets. They just have visiting jets from other NATO countries, and they kind of rotate there. So every six months, they have some squadron from somewhere else, but they don't have their own. And I'm 150% we don't need them at all in Croatia, but we need, you know, millions and millions more to invest in R&D and research and basic science, and then from that applied science. So I'm sure that, you know, a common voice of the communities and the ecosystems that we have here to push for that across the region is one very simple example. So we all say to all our governments, instead of 0.75, we must have 2% investment in R&D by XYZ year. And then we just keep on pushing that single message. So as a, let's say, ad hoc example.
Okay. Before we continue with you two, I just want to know, do we have questions that we need to answer from the audience?
A couple of very interesting questions.
Because I don't see.
We can't see.
No.
I'll read the first. It's to you, actually. It's just a nice question.
No, don't give him the word again. We need to hear the other two.
Interesting question, and probably it's important for everybody. The question is, can you name three successful startups from Bulgaria? Why tech media is not so excited to cover Balkans, news from the Balkans? Maybe that's true, maybe it's not, but it's an interesting question. So what do you think, there is collaboration in the Balkans in the sense of news or other things? And is it true that you don't cover that much the Balkans? I don't know. You're founder of TechEU, right?
Co-founder, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, okay. So probably that's the question about. But it's an interesting one. That's why I read it.
Well, as I mentioned, we started TechEU, and we're still doing that with the intention to move. Obviously, we're covering also the big cities. But absolutely, we are. We do have an intention. We are on the ground in many different cities. So I hope we are covering. Obviously, every you know, every ecosystem would probably say you're not covering us enough. But and I didn't do any statistical analysis. But yeah, we are. I think we are doing that job.
Thanks. Okay, maybe you can.
Actually, honestly, no, not on the top of my head. I know there was one, I can't remember the name, but there was one coming out of either 11 or Launch Hub that had to do with media and that got an investment from, not Kleiner Perkins, but from the Draper Fund.
Yeah.
And they went to California, but again, I can't exactly remember the name of the company.
That's Flips, I think.
And there was a security company quite some time ago that was co-founded by Morten Lund up in Denmark. Bull something. Yeah, Everbred was also, but that kind of went up and down a little bit.
I'm not sure about that. But that's a good question because at the end of the
day, I asked this question. I think it's a really important question. As obviously a lot of things have to do to be done in Bulgaria and the region, but we also have to push a bit harder. And I think as you, as a co-founder of one of this, great media that I also follow, it's really important, like you being part of this ecosystem, living in the area, to push our agenda. So this is my call. I didn't want to embarrass you.
No, no, it's okay.
But I just wanted to say, hey, come on. There are great startups that needs to be covered. Well, you live among them. You don't know them.
Let me come back to you with a response. Do you know how many press releases I and my colleagues get every day in our emails?
I don't know. It's
believe
not my
me,
job.
Believe me, a huge amount. Very few of those are from the region. So it's up to the regional
companies. Do you know why? Because we gave up on that. Because we have more important things to do. Because we never go through.
Well, if you give up, if you give up, then you can't complain.
I mean, okay. Okay.
Thanks.
Because you said you covered, but you didn't cover. You wait for information, so it's different.
So we have a few more minutes, so maybe Grigoris and Vele can share their view on how do we collaborate in the next few years on the Balkans.
I hate to be a party breaker here, but I would say that I don't really like too much this discussion about how we can collaborate in the Balkans. It's a little bit introvert looking.
Okay.
I want to say that the people who did it outside of the Balkans in the world are the ones who are not known as Bulgarian startups or as a Serbian research institute or as a Macedonian company. They're the people who are known as being good at what they do. And in that sense, I think that a good service we can offer to our ecosystem, of course, to continue taking part and being active players and exchange ideas, but a good service we can offer to our ecosystem is try to get a way of being the best in our village and try to be good ones in the big city. So in that sense, I would really like to see more companies being integrated into the European and global ecosystems.
Okay, I like that
point. And that's a good point. One of the challenges, at least in Macedonia, that I've seen is difficulty to think beyond sort of the limited borders. And if you look at sort of the Western Balkans, it's not a big region. It's just too many borders in that one place. And that a lot of times affects how people think, which markets to address and where to go and how. So, cooperation can be in a sense of thinking how from each of these locations the startups can see a pathway to either greater funding, accessing new markets, or growing from that perspective. If anything, a more realistic type of cooperation I can see is in the R&D, but I think it's very difficult to put that into practice. So what I would just simply think about is encouraging a lot of these startups from many different cities to go and meet and pick up and source talent and look for help and growth opportunities from the region as well.
Okay, thanks. I think our time is up. So it was really nice to have you here on stage. I think we can continue the conversation
offline.
Yes. And I guess Nicola can take it from there. Thank you very much.
Thank you guys for the participation on the stage. Сега предлагам да направим една кратка 15-минутна почивка и след това да се върнем, за да си говорим за киберсигурност и всъщност да си хакнем нашия собствен уебсайт. една по-дълга почивка. Мисля, че можем малко по малко започнем да се събираме. Супер! Има прогрес. Изчакваме още малко. Заповядайте, не се срамете. Заповядайте, има места, има места. Отпред най-вече. Добре. Така, направихме, както споменахме, една дълга приятна почивка. И сега започваме с нещо малко по-различно. И ще започна с едни благодарности към вас. Благодаря ви, че проявихте отговорност към вашата киберсигурност в днешно време. Защо? Ще разберете след малко. От Александър, от Радослав Милчев, съжалявам, и колегите му от Техническия университет. Благодарим им за демонстрацията предварително. Без излишни приказки, защото хакерите не им се кефят много. Заповядайте.
Надявам се, че се чува в залата или... Да. Здравейте. Още един път добър ден на всички. Радвам се, че дори в този малко по-късен следобеден час все още има достатъчно интерес в залата. И съответно ще се опитаме да демонстрираме нещо, което представлява интерес от гледна точка на системите за управление на съдържание, която всяка една организация и съответно стопански субект обикновено поддържат като част от своето бизнес портфолио. Сега, разбира се, идеята беше да направим една демонстрация на живо, но от гледна точка на условията, в които се намираме в момента, ние преработихме малко представянето, така че елементът, който ще бъде живата част на презентацията, ще бъда аз, а всичко останало, което в момента искаме да демонстрираме, ще покажем чрез подходящи видеа, които в момента ще онагледат цялостно процеса, който искаме да демонстрираме. Моето име е Радослав Милчев. Разбира се, първо искам да благодаря на госпожа Безуханова, че заедно с моите колеги Александър Цокиев и Йордан Йорданов от Техническия университет бяхме поканени, за да направим това кратко представяне на някои възможни, съответно в момента, пробиви в информационната сигурност, които за съжаление засягат съответно нашите всекидневни дейности, т.е. засягат дейностите съответно в момента, които имаме, както в различните по обем организации, така разбира се и в стопанските субекти, които използват подобни системи. Добре е да започнем с една интересна мисъл на Джон Чеймбърс, който всъщност казва, че има два типа компании. Разбира се, единият тип компании са тези, които вече са били хакнати, а вторият тип компании са тези, които все още не знаят, че са хакнати, но вече съответно в момента са минали през този процес. За съжаление, процеса в момента, който е свързан с управление на информационната сигурност, трябва постоянно да бъде наблюдаван от организациите и наистина трябва да бъде вложено необходимото време, усилие и, разбира се, средства, за да могат да бъдат избегнати съответно тези елементи. В началото бих искал да покажа някои от важните аспекти на киберсигурността от гледна точка на това, на което могат всяката от организациите да бъдат съответно в момента подложени. От гледна точка на съществуващи практики, всъщност това, което се вижда, може би не е достатъчно добре, е една ценова листа, която всъщност потребителите могат да бъдат и съответно са достъпни като цени от гледна точка на организации и, разбира се, частни лица, които предоставят различни услуги, които са свързани с компрометиране на информационната сигурност. Всъщност, тези цени, които в момента виждате, са изведени от Fortune Magazine, които всъщност са направили подобно изследване и са дали възможност в момента на водещите съответно в момента организации, разбира се, да станат свидетели на това какви са всъщност възможностите, които биха могли да компрометират информационната сигурност при тях. Разбира се, това нещо може да бъде видяно и съответно илюстрирано и с едно друго интересно изследване, което е на групата Rapid 7. Всъщност това изследване в момента показва, че дори за последното 3 месече на тази година, както в момента виждате, максималният брой атаки дневно може да достигне съответно до 750 и съответно 1000. Средно в момента имаме по 20-30 атаки към всяка една организация и всяка една от тези атаки до известна степен е свързана с възможности за компрометиране на информационната сигурност и процесите, с които работим. Както виждате, всъщност засегнати са абсолютно всички индустрии. За съжаление, тази съответно в момента диаграма в топлата гама, която виждате, колкото по-топло е в момента цвета, толкова, за съжаление, по-голям е броят на атаките и проблемите, които в момента съществуват с информационната сигурност в дадената индустрия. Всъщност, вероятно ви прави впечатление, че финансовата индустрия и съответно в момента услугите, които са свързани с застраховки, са изключително в момента високо подложени на подобни атаки и, за съжаление, имат редица проблеми. С това кратко начало бихме искали съответно в момента да демонстрираме част от проблемите, които възникват по отношение на информационната сигурност. За целите на днешното събитие ние вдигнахме всъщност в момента една реална система. Тази система в момента е позиционирана в Техническия университет София. Тя има всъщност реален IP адрес. Както виждате, в момента има известно домейн име, което сме задали. Другото нещо, което е важно, тъй като искахме да демонстрираме проблемите, които биха имали някои от съвременните системи за управление на съдържание, инсталирахме съответно система за управление на съдържание, която е широко използвана, както ще видите след малко. Всъщност става въпрос за продукта WordPress в неговата последна версия. Средата, в която функционира, респективно в момента е Web Server Engines. Нямаме допълнителни инструменти и елементи, съответно в момента, които са на защитата. Идеята е да тестваме възможностите, ако, примерно, да кажем, дадена организация или стопански субект просто реши да се възползва от възможностите, които предоставя един подобен информационен продукт, инсталира го съответно в момента на своите ресурси и респективно в момента какво ще бъде резултата, ако нямаме, примерно, да кажем, разпределение на съдържанието в този сайт или, примерно, да кажем, в момента, ако нямаме система, която да предотвратява различните форми на атака и то тази система съответно в момента не е от последно поколение. За да можем да демонстрираме по-добре възможностите, сме показали и съответно сме инсталирали модул, който се използва широко. Този модул в момента позволява на потребителите да използват своите акаунти от други информационни системи. От гледна точка на това, все пак в момента да имаме един акаунт, с който да можем да влизаме в различните информационни системи и ресурси, в случая съответно в нашия корпоративен ресурс. Сега, обръщам внимание, че проблемите, които в момента ще покажем, реално погледнато могат да възникнат наистина за всяка организация и от гледна точка все пак на общите рамки, които в момента съществуват в Европейския съюз и това, което в момента искаме да въведем като политика за управление и съхранение на личните данни, още от 2018 година. Вероятно, голяма част от организациите, които не използват правилно подобен тип системи, за съжаление, могат да изпитат сериозни проблеми с информационната сигурност. Така че това, което ние ще разгледаме, системата WordPress, защо разглеждаме, както виждате в момента, според множество изследвания, това е една от най-широко разпространените системи за управление на съдържание. Разбира се, тя си има редица предимства, има и някои недостатъци. Идеята в момента е, че ако вие оставите системата в нейния базов вариант и, разбира се, не приложите други средства за защита, проблемите могат да бъдат изключително сериозни. Това, което ще използваме като инструмент, е стандартен инструмент, той е широко достъпен, безплатен. Използваме в момента този инструмент от гледна точка на анализите, които бихме искали да направим за сайт, който в момента поддържа системата за управление на съдържание WordPress. Виждате в момента нашия сайт, генерирали сме едно примерно съдържание, за да става въпрос все пак за хакване на система, която има някакви реални стойности и показатели. Така че в нашата ситуация виждате, че системата е напълно функционираща, имаме възможности съответно да правим търсене, да разглеждаме отделните инструменти. Така че нашата цел в момента е да проучиме какво е състоянието на тази информационна система и какви са възможностите. Както казахме, продуктът WordPress Scan, който в момента виждате, е изключително подходящ за работа на всякакви потребители. Значи от нещо, което ние в момента забелязваме като тенденции в последните години, в много от случаите се оказва, че хората не трябва да имат някакви изключително високи съответно познания, за да могат да направят, за съжаление, примерно да кажем в момента и да нанесат вреда на подобна организация. Първото нещо, което е важно, да направим апдейт на системата. Виждате, в момента стремим се към този апдейт, за да можем да изтеглиме последните добавки, които има в базата данни на този инструмент, от гледна точка на възможни технологични пропуски, които са били установени. Оттам нататък в момента правим сканиране на нашата система, т.е. сканираме директно по нашето DNS име и в тази ситуация вече можем да погледнем какви са параметрите на системата, която ние сме инсталирали. Сега обръщам внимание, че този инструмент може да бъде използван в две качества. От една страна, когато ние се стремиме да анализираме информационната сигурност в нашата организация, и втория случай, за съжаление, тъй като е широко достъпен, от хора, които в момента имат, за съжаление, някакви други цели, които са си поставили спрямо нашите ресурси. В момента виждате подчертаната част, всъщност се оказва, че тази версия, която в момента използваме, вече има установен технологичен пропуск. За съжаление, този технологичен пропуск все още не е затворен. И това нещо в момента поставя необходимостта ние наистина да анализираме и, разбира се, да защитиме чрез други инструменти съдържанието, което в момента предоставяме. Както вече споменах, системата позволява чрез възможностите съответно за помощ, ние директно да изберем режима, в който искаме да направим анализа, така че сега ще направим един анализ на всички приставки, които са инсталирали към системата. Анализа на приставките, които в момента имаме към системите за управление на съдържание, е изключително важен, по проста причина, че тези системи могат да бъдат използвани за различни цели във вашите организации. Значи самата система WordPress може в момента да варира от портално решение, примерно да кажем през система, която участва в процеса на обучение, или примерно да кажем в момента решава някаква друга критична бизнес дейност във вашата организация. Така че задачата, която имаме, е да направим в момента анализ не само на самата система, но и на тези приставки, които в момента сме инсталирали и които са инсталирани от отсрещната страна. Защото най-често проблемите, които в момента идентифицираме, са свързани с допълнителните приспособления и модули, които в момента използват организациите. Ето тук вече виждаме, че започва съответно този анализ. За рамките в момента на теста, както виждате, използваме само тези приставки, които са с най-висок рейтинг. Общо взето те в момента са 1500, така че на този етап ние в момента анализираме над 1500 възможности, които евентуално от срещната страна може в момента да има. Резултатите показват, че системата в момента има инсталирани 4 приставки, които представляват интерес, особено съответно в момента една от тези приставки, User Pro, която всъщност ми позволява да използвам моя акаунт, примерно да кажем от Facebook или от друга съответно социална мрежа, за да мога да се регистрирам в системата и съответно да работя. За съжаление, както в момента виждате, има достатъчно възможности да направим различни типове заявки. Ето това са само пропуски технологични, които са свързани с WordPress. Така че бихме могли в момента да изследваме както технологичните пропуски на тази система за управление на съдържание, така съответно в момента и технологичните пропуски на конкретния модул, който в момента идентифицирахме в процеса, разбира се, на анализ на отсрещната страна. Така че бихме могли да използваме вградените инструменти, можем да използваме съответно в момента интернет-базирани бази от данни. Примерно подобна интернет-базирана база от данни представлява ExploitDB, както в момента ще видите на сайта, който ще отворим и ще разгледаме. Всъщност са достъпни в архив над 38 000 различни официално регистрирани технологични пропуски, които в момента са открити в различни видове системи. Значи всичко това е достъпно широко, така че реално погледнато би трябвало персонала на организацията повече или по-малко да има реална представа за всеки един от тези технологични пропуски, които са свързани с системите, с които в момента управлява. Сега, разбира се, търсенето, което в момента правиме, е свързано с използването на WordPress конкретно, но реално погледнато, ако вие имате желание, можете да погледнете и другите системи за управление на съдържание, които присъстваха на предишната диаграма, също имат голям брой установени съответно в момента технологични пропуски. Установихме в момента технологичен пропуск, който реално погледнато е от дата 4 ноември 2017 година. Този пропуск, който в момента виждате, е съвсем нов с този блок. Единственото нещо, което трябва да направи този потребител, който евентуално иска да тества сигурността и проблема евентуално дали съществува в неговата система, е просто да добави в командния ред и в адресното пространство един допълнителен текстов низ. Този допълнителен текстов низ, след като бъде съответно добавен, дава възможности директно да влезнете като администратор в системата. В момента тестваме нашия сайт. Както виждате, опитваме съответно спрямо стандартното потребителско име да влеземе с някои произволни пароли, често срещани обикновено. Виждаме, че все пак в момента администраторите на сайта са го защитили от тази гледна точка. Тогава вече въвеждаме допълнителния текстов низ. Въвеждането на този текстов низ в момента, както виждате, ще ми даде пълните администраторски права. Току-що в момента има възможност да ме поздрави като администратор. Така че в тази ситуация какво става? Вече имаме пълен достъп до бекенда на системата. Това в момента ни позволява, както виждате, ако имаме желание да променим съдържанието, съответно в момента, което е публикувано в тази система за управление на съдържание, имаме възможности съответно в момента да достъпиме профилите на отделните потребители, да създадем наши потребители, които в момента, примерно да кажем, да бъдат регистрирани в тази система за управление. Така че от тази гледна точка, за съжаление, както вече казахме, процесите, които в момента са свързани с управление на информационната сигурност, са изключително сложни. Тук се извинявам за голямото О в DOS-а, всъщност DOS или Denial of Service атака. Ако нашият сайт в момента покаже достатъчно добри параметри по отношение на възможностите си за защита, от гледна точка на, примерно, атаките, които току-що направихме, за съжаление, винаги е възможно, съответно в момента, организацията да бъде подложена и на друг тип атаки. Значи, при предишния тип атака идеята беше в момента да придобиеме права върху този сайт и съответно ресурса като цяло. Тук в момента идеята е да ограничиме достъпа на потребителите, които имат реални права да ползват съответно в момента този сайт. За съжаление, както вече казахме, един от най-важните активи в момента, който имаме за всяка една организация и стопански субект, това е информацията. Така че достъпа съответно до информационните ресурси може реално погледнато да наруши съответно вашата бизнес практика, може да доведе съответно в момента до редица проблеми, част от тях и чисто финансови, т.е. да търпите чисто финансови загуби. Така че в тази ситуация, какво биха могли да направят съответно в момента вашите инженери по сигурност, или, за съжаление, хората, които в момента са решили да тестват информационната сигурност на нашите ресурси. Първото нещо, което мога да направя, е широко използван инструмент, както NMAP. Той ми позволява съответно да сканирам от срещната страна. Мога да видя всичко общо заето от сигнатурата на операционната система до отворените портове, оттам да направя анализ на това какви услуги в момента са стартирани. Както виждате, не само съответно в момента видяхме, че е отворен 80-ти порт, видяхме съответно версията на веб-сървъра, видяхме възможностите на операционната система, което пък създава допълнителни възможности, за съжаление, за атака, съответно в момента към нашата система. В нашия случай, тъй като се стремиме съответно да ограничиме достъпа на законните потребители към ресурса, който в момента сме пуснали, реално погледнато ще натовариме системата, т.е. ще отправиме 10 000 заявки, като тези 10 000 заявки ще бъдат съответно стартирани по 250 заявки в секунда. Така че целта в момента е сайта, който сме пуснали, в случая включително на нашата машина, реално погледнато да влезе в режим отказ от обслужване. Тоест няма да може да зарежда съответно в момента официалните потребители. Както виждате, постепенно съответно, първоначално започва да изпитва сайта известни затруднения, да връща отговор на заявките на потребителите. В момента ме беше изхвърлял, след малко ще опитам отново, тъй като все още броя на заявките, които съм направил, не са го натоварили достатъчно. И по тази причина все още имам възможности, както виждате, да се свързвам с сайта. След известен период от време, всъщност заявките в момента, които виждате като връзки, станаха вече над 3000. От тези съответно в момента над 3000 заявки, имаше включително 3400 затворени. От тук нататък сайта влезен съответно в момента перманентно в режим denial of service, т.е. отказ от обслужване. За съжаление, тъй като имахме съответно в момента разрешението на госпожа Безуханова, ние тествахме тази атака и върху техния сайт. Разбира се, само с нейно разрешение. За съжаление, резултатът беше наистина тежък, т.е. успяхме да свалиме сайта, но само за определен период от време. Да, сайта на конференцията, извинявам се, наистина това беше важно. Сега, обръщам внимание, че днес нямаше да бъде вече честно да правим повторно в момента подобна демонстрация, още повече, че все пак тук ние сме гости и реално погледнато това няма да бъде съответно в момента прието по закона за гостоприемството като цяло. Така че Затова не си позволяваме в момента да направим това нещо. Сега, искам да обърнете внимание, че всъщност нашата задача тук не беше просто да покажем колко лесно може да се хакне една система, която няма необходимите защити. Идеята в момента беше все пак да покажем, че първо инструментите са широко достъпни и на второ място все пак ние трябва да спазваме определена политика за сигурност. Значи, ако една организация или стопански субект няма разписана политика за сигурност и няма съответно в момента начин по който да се действа при различни инциденти, реално погледнато това нещо би било голям проблем за по-нататъчното нейно функциониране и съответно управление на информационните ресурси. По принцип, атаките, които в момента видяхте, са лесно реализуеми по простата причина, че съответно ресурса, който в момента сме дигнали, има някои технологични пропуски от една страна, имаме съответно в момента пропуски, които са свързани с конфигурирането на отсрещната система и разбира се с поддръжката, която в момента, примерно да кажем, е била направена. Как бихме могли да избегнем подобни действия? Всъщност, навсякъде, където имате потребители по подразбиране, съответно пуснати услуги по подразбиране, добре е тези съответно потребители услуги да бъдат ограничени. Ако вие изпълнявате подобни действия, както вече виждате, тук атаката е възможна, тъй като потребителя, съответно в момента, който използвам по подразбиране, който системата ни препоръчва, е съответно админ и по тази причина нещата стават достатъчно лесно. Потенциален проблем в момента представляват и приложенията, т.е. допълнителните модули, които в момента ние имаме и използваме към нашите системи, за да можем да разширим техния обхват. За съжаление, в момента в тези модули, ако вие погледнете ресурса, който посочихме в нашата презентация, ще ви направи впечатление, че над 90% от технологичните пропуски са свързани именно с тези допълнителни модули. Така че, когато в момента една организация използва подобен модул, а този модул, който виждате, той е комерциален, т.е. има комерциална версия. Ако вие в момента използвате подобни версии, включително съответно с отворен код или комерциални на дадения продукт, с който работиме, за съжаление ще трябва постоянно да се информирате за състоянието на информационната сигурност, конкретно за него. По принцип, пропуските, които в момента са свързани с самата система като цяло, са доста по-малко, отколкото това, което в момента виждаме, чрез тези модули, които са разработка на трети страни. Другото нещо, което в момента е изключително важно, важно е в момента персонала, който се занимава с проблемите на информационните и комуникационни технологии в организацията, респективно постоянно да прави тестове на системата. Грубо казано, това означава, че той трябва постоянно да прави опити за хакване на тези системи, за да може да установява слабости и проблеми и респективно да взима съответно отношение по тяхното отстраняване. Сега, по принцип, необходимо организациите в момента да инвестират и в своята инфраструктура. Значи IDS, IPS системите са нещо, което в момента е важно за функционирането на тези организации, особено когато става въпрос за организации, които в момента са достатъчно големи като мащаб и съответно ресурсите, които в момента предоставят, са изключително важни. Сега, обръщам внимание, че от тази гледна точка използването на системи, които са за управление на информационната сигурност и инцидентите, свързани с информационна сигурност, също са важен елемент от една подобна политика и практика. Ако вие имате възможности и съответно в момента вашия ресурс е изключително важен, т.е. примерно да кажем, вие управлявате електронен магазин. В тази ситуация е добре този електронен магазин да бъде съответно стартиран и управляван като разпределен ресурс. Т.е. CDN-а, който в момента виждате, ще бъде изключително важен за неговото правилно функциониране. Ако тази атака беше приложена съответно в момента към електронен магазин, очевидно в тази ситуация организацията ще губи достатъчно много. Така че това са само част от мерките, които бихме могли да предприемеме, за да можем реално, наистина, да управляваме процеса на информационната сигурност. Така че аз благодаря за вашето внимание и търпение, за това, което в момента демонстрирахме. Както вече казах, атаката е толкова бързо провеждаща се, че аз би трябвало за 10 секунди да ви покажа какво става с сайта и след това да си тръгна. Все пак исках да имам удоволствието да мога да ви поговоря 15 минути. Благодаря за вниманието.
Благодарим много за демото. Имайте предвид все пак, че това, което видяхте, е на доста малък мащаб. Едни не толкова приятни статистики показват, че до 2019 година кибератаките ще струват загуби за над 2 трилиона долара. Тоест това е един вече още по-огромен мащаб. Но добре, че следващият ни гост е тук, за да ни помогне. На гости ни е Жан-Пьер Нордвик, шеф отдел киберсигурност и дигитална сигурност на гражданите, Joint Research Center, Европейска комисия. Аплодисменти!
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to be in Sofia. Again, last time was 10 years ago. Today is a great weather outside. And I have quite a challenge now because there is written solution somehow. And after the demonstration we just had, I need now to convince you there is a solution in front of us. And you may think that I am solution. No, I'm not the solution. But I'm a tiny part of it. And you also, and if we all work together, if we all realize that we need to be united, that we need to break our fragmentation, that we need to learn from each other, then maybe we will be able to have resilient, secure IT system in the future. To sustain my talk, I have to tell you a few things about me, otherwise you would not understand from what perspective I'm giving this short speech. I'm an engineer. I'm good in artificial intelligence, the one that was developed in 85. Do you know Lisp? Is there anyone who has heard of Lisp? Oh, God. Do you still program on Lisp, with Lisp? A few hands I do. I still do, but nobody understands me, so apart from a few ones. I also had a startup in 85. We were basically selling to small and medium enterprises computers that could talk to each other with the cables and that could share a shared printer. That was a start of network. But that was not enough for me, and honestly, I was much more triggered by working in research, so I joined a public service, European Commission, and worked there for 25 years in research, and for the last 10 years, I've been working as a head of a cyber and digital citizen security unit, providing research, evidence-based facts to support the big machinery, which is typically in Brussels, for the design and implementation of European legislations. And I think I have a privilege here, and I have to thank very much the organizer for giving me this space here, to give you a little bit from the inside what one of the 30,000 civil servants working for the college, and in particular for Commissioner Gabriel, tried to reach and try to respond to the very strong leadership that we have, especially in the context of digital economy. So, let's see if this works. I don't think many things have been said, so I will go very fast. We need to understand, and I think you understand as well as me, how cyberspace is different from our normal material physical reality. Things that is happening there has never happened in the real world before. We think that in front of us the next 20 years will be an evolution of the anthropological species of humankind that has not been seen over the last 200 years. People think of the first revolution of mankind, and in fact this cyberspace is simply our becoming our reality. There is a merging, the two things are getting together, and this digital society is basically providing the substrate for our digital transformation. And I understand in the room there are many Bulgarian or West Balkan startups about a new digital services, but as it was stated before, this digital transformation is impacting every business and everyone of us. Look at the car industry, there's no more selling cars today, it's about selling smart mobility, and projections say that in 10 years' time we will have automated car driving ourselves without any needs for a driver anymore. This is a change of model. It has changed quite a lot, and we need to be prepared for that, especially those who have not yet been touched by this digital revolution. So let's try to see what are these cybersecurity issues are coming from. First, they come by the existing vulnerabilities that we have in our IT system. And this comes First of all, by the fact that we do not have monolithic system. They are interconnected, and more they're interconnected to this kind of smart devices, or not so smart devices, Internet of things, which is basically making the profile, the envelope of security, extremely difficult now to assess and to protect. A very famous crypto guy, Shamir, one of the three founders of this very much used cryptographic algorithm, said in a recent conference that IoT is a disaster in the making. At the same time, we are not facing a world which is no digital and it becomes digital. Digitalization has started many years ago, 20, 30 years ago, and we have a lot of legacy systems, unpatched systems, which are offering also a number of vulnerabilities. We have mentioned poor compliance, poor hygiene, the lack of digital skill, of training, and we've seen that it is easy to get resources to hack systems. These are our vulnerabilities. But without the bad guys, the vulnerability could not be exploited. So we are threatened because we have villains. We have bad guys which can use and exploit these vulnerabilities. And of course, we are far away from the initial hackers. We are an industry about cyber criminals. We can monitor their work, actually. They work 40 hours a week. They stop during the weekend. They probably have social insurance, some part of the world. It's a real industry. And it's a real industry, and some of these activity are also sponsored by states, by foreign forces, and we know that this is a threat also to our very basic democratic functions. Then cybercrime and cyber criminals are very much connected to organized crime and to terrorism. All these things are all together in a way, and more the political efforts is no more directed only on cybercrime. It's taking it all together: counterterrorism, organized crime, and fight cyber crimes. And then you have everybody who can now buy very easily some resources in order to perform for some easy money a cybercrime. We see that cybercrime as a service, it was exemplified before. Oops, sorry. Then when we have threats and vulnerability, we have crimes, we have risk, they are materialized, and this is really a problem for our single market. They have, the bad guys, they have already an integrated single market. We do not have that yet. But citizen shows that trust in the benefit of a digital economy is increasing, but the trust in our services and our capacity to face cybersecurity is decreasing. And we see that by the number of cybersecurity incidents that we have coming. So this is made even worse if you look at the darknet, or the grey web, or the darknet, where the real industry and the real marketplace are taking place. Okay, you can look at the last report of Europol, the European Cybersecurity Crime, and you will have all the detail on the statistics of this growing industry. So, will computer will never be safe? Indeed, probably they will never be safe. I would like them to be, but probably if we were all together, then we will reach a point on security that is bearable, especially if we can decide on the liability of the residual risk that remains. But the key message is that we need to fry fragmentation. And I heard with attention the different panels, we see fragmentations, geographical fragmentations between countries, between regions. We see horizontal fragmentation between regions, states, and the Commission. We also see fragmentation between industry, vertical industry, ICT industry, e-health industry, car industry, transport industry, and so on. And I also see a dichotomy between the business thriving dynamics of a country and the academia and the research and the public services. We need to unite this and to work all together. And this conference is really a step in the right directions. Also, the Commission is trying its best to do something. At the same time of the state, the speech on the State of the Union of President Juncker on 13 September, there was issued what is becoming de facto the new cyber security strategy on resilience, deterrence, and defense. Let's try to look at these three terms. And I quickly speak about defense. It is clear that nowadays there's not so much difference anymore between the military fields and the civil fields. As a matter of fact, militaries are using more and more off-the-shelf civil equipment. The hybrid threat is up and growing, and we see that there's a convergence now on funding research from defense and for civil applications. On resilience, a number of proposals have been made forward, and they've already been listed, most of them, by our commissioners. So the revamping of ENISA into a full-stage permanent EU cybersecurity agency. But I'd like to say a few words on the main mandate which is proposed for this agency, which is about certifications. Cybersecurity certification of IT product and services. This is a very important proposal put forward, which is not going to be easy to win adhesion in the Parliament and in the Council. We know that, but it, I think, very fundamental. We need to make sure that we can certify a certain level of security on a voluntary base for our products and services. Clearly, you're not going to expect a full-fledged common criteria certification for small devices or IoT. So this EU-wide certification framework needs to be able to adjust depending on the target and depending on the security assurance that you want to achieve, but we need to have that EU cybersecurity certification. And probably we need to have it at a certain moment in time also mandatory. The last panel mentioned also the importance of research and innovation. This is a subject of the proposal for the creation of a European research and competence centers, which would kind of federate and animate a network of national competence centers. This is a very important proposal too. It will bring within one roof all funding related to research and innovation, funding coming from the industry itself, from the national governments, and from the commissions. And the idea is really to be able to drive research in the direction requested by the market in order to deliver to the market and to the industry what is needed in terms of technology. Then we have the response with the blueprint, and we have the issue of digital skills education and awareness raising. A lot has been said about digital skills, so I'm not going to repeat, but I will add a few things. First, in the lack of digital skills, we need to take into account also the gender balance. It is an opportunity also to bring women much more into IT. It is very important, these things. There's been some women on the stage, but not in the panels, for instance. In my team of 42 persons, I only recruited the last year the first two engineers in ICT because there were none. So we need to build, to work also in that direction. And it does not start with university, where we should have indeed very well defined, targeted, harmonized cybersecurity corpus. It needs to start earlier. It needs to start with children, medium school, and even earlier. It's a part of digital hygiene, it's part of awareness raisings, and we've been putting forward a number of proposals in that direction. I'd like also to underline one point, which is about zero-day vulnerabilities. What you've seen there were about vulnerabilities that were known, but what about those who are not known, who are discovered by some research groups? What do they do with that? Do they sell it on the black market? Or do they kind of prompt it to bring it in a responsible way so that the responsible industry can do something about it? This is about a very important proposal also put forward, action put forward on duty of care and responsible zero-day disclosure. Deterrence, very quickly, because we most of the time keep on working on resilience, but we forget that we also need to catch the bad guys. And we need to work for that with law enforcement authorities. It is fundamental that law enforcement authorities become equipped with the right technical tools in order to be able to face the challenges that they have in front of them, which is basically to catch the bad guys who are extremely good in ICT, while they are not really good in ICT. There are market opportunities also there as well. Then quickly about data, since we talked a lot about cybersecurity, what we want to do with our cybersecurity to protect our critical infrastructure, our businesses, but also the data which are exchanges. And we know it was said that data is a new oil and that we're producing a lot of data. So for this reason, we have to make sure that this data can free flow within Europe. No problem for that. We've seen we had a regulation proposed recently as a commission, and major steps forward in terms of agreement at council and parliament was recently announced, in particular with respect to geolocalization. This is extremely good for business and should give more certainty and confidence that you can make business with non-personal data outside of your own country. And then we have the free flow of personal data. And for that, I will argue that we have an excellent tool, which is the General Data Protection Regulation. It is strange because normally people present GDPR as basically the fact that we had the fundamental right on data protection and privacy, and now we have the GDPR and that's it. Actually, GDPR was there in order to make sure that this right is respected in a fully modern digital society, taking advantage of flow of data, of personal flow data. So GDPR is a positive right. Everything is permitted if you respect some basic rules. Okay? So we should not see general the European GDPR as something blocking business. It is all the contrary. It is an opportunity. It is also an opportunity, which I go more quickly now, when we will address the issue of machine learning and artificial intelligence. I'll skip the other one. No, perhaps a few things on quantum technology. Quantum technology is also extremely important. Okay? Not so many people talk about that. I've heard for 30 years that the quantum technology revolution is 20 years in front of me, but it looks that actually recently a major progress has been made, and indeed we will probably have in 10, 15 years quantum computing. This will allow brutal attack on most of the existing encrypted data which exists today, which are subject or vulnerable to this type of parallel attack. And this creates an issue for us. We need to build quickly and to have research in order to build post-quantum technology. These traditional cryptologies which would resist a quantum computing attack. And then we have machine learning and AI, which are really changing the way we will look at our society in the next years. It is clearly an exponential tendency. We see more and more machines which are intelligent enough to simulate the behavior of human beings. We need to be also very careful with these kind of things, because these machines will become much better than us in doing things which are fully, which can be automated. They will simulate us, and we will lose that battle if we fight the things that the machines are better than us in doing. Responding to questions, perception, but asking the right question, being critical, being creative, and knowing what is right to do and not how to do it right, is something that remains with human beings. So there are tendencies about human obsolescence. This is taken from this week issues of The Economist. And you see that we see obsolescence, they see, or the Oxford study sees obsolescence of human beings in a number of years in the future. We need to be careful here. We need to be careful on how we use the technology and how we embody it in our technologies when we apply them, the right values. And from that perspective, in Europe, we have many good values. And we have also the right legislative context and the right unions to have these values within our technologies to protect our humanity. And if you want to follow up on this interesting topic, I think fascinating, on technologies versus humanity, I point there to a book from Gert Leonard, which is really revealing in that respect. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Jean-Pierre. След последните два разговора, аз честно казвам, започвам да подозирам почти всеки един от вас в задни кибер помисли. Не знам за вас. Сега по-сериозно малко. Всъщност видяхме, че потенциалните и сегашни като цяло загуби за бизнеса са големи, така че сме поканили плеяда от експерти, които да разнищят въпроса. Нашият модератор се е подготвил да хакне формата за твърде общо говорене за киберсигурност. Моля, посрещнете Али Пирзада, лидер за услугите, свързани с корпоративни злоупотреби и бизнес спорове, Ernst & Young България, Република Македония, Албания и Косово. Аплодисменти!
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for your time. Thank you for joining us here today. Even before I start, I thank EDIT4tomorrow for organizing this conference and inviting all of us here. I would also like at the same time to invite my panel colleagues to come and step up here with us so that we can begin the conference together.
All of us.
Gentlemen.
Yeah. Well.
I'll begin by introducing my colleague speakers here today. We've got Philip Genov from UniCredit Bank. He's the head of special projects there. Georgi Dimitrov, chairperson, Law and Internet Foundation. We've got Vladan Todorovic. He is from Serbia. He's a cybersecurity senior professional who does a lot of work in the Western Balkans and in the Asia Pacific. We've got Jean-Pierre Nordvik. We've already heard with him. He's joining us again here right now. And we've got Velizar Shalamanov, who is from the Bulgarian Academy of Sciences and the Institute of Information and Communication Technologies. Before I start the discussion in earnest, it is quite evident that the world has gone, like Jean-Pierre was saying, way back in 1985. So we've gone from tech to high tech to digital, and we're now talking about a cyber future and cyberspace. With all things great also come opportunities, but at the same time come threats as well. At this present moment in time, we are talking about a future which is interconnected, a generation of people which has grown up being connected to their environment, to machines, to each other, through networks, through technology, but it also exposes us to a darker threat, which we are all aware of, but it needs to be discussed further. At the present moment in time, in Europe and all around the world, in a lot of countries, legislation is being developed in order to address the issue of cybercrime. These laws could be considered an opportunity. They could be considered a constraint. At the same time, they're also giving rise to a lot of tensions in various communities. But we all believe that if we have to progress in the future, then all stakeholders in various communities need to come together and discuss these issues and discuss these laws as well. Before we start the discussion, let me throw a few very interesting things that most of us are aware of, but they give some context to the discussion we're having today. By the year 2020, which is just around the corner, we will have a complete new generation of people, which includes us, which have gotten used to the fact that we are connected to our environment. The Internet of Things is around, which means more and more and more devices in our life will be connected to each other, and we will be using either voice commands or just using those things as part of normal daily life. geopolitical turbulences, which are increasingly becoming a part of today's reality. And they're not only on a political level, they're at an economic level as well, where most nations are competing with each other for competitive advantage. And the cyber world that we're talking about gives more opportunities to achieve competitive advantage over each other than the traditional economic world that we knew of. As a result, by 2050, it is predicted that the top 10 economies of the world will be mostly in Asia and South America. The USA will be somewhere down on the seventh place, and just one or two of the European countries will be part of the top 10. Cyber criminals. Lloyd's just recently published a report which said that every year globally we're losing around $400 billion worth of business money to cyber criminals. And by the year 2020, globally businesses will be investing around $170 billion on cybersecurity. So interesting times ahead, opportunities, threats. I would like to quote something that Mr. Spiegel's presentation mentioned earlier. The CEO of Atomico, which if I can quote, said that legislation should not be considered a threat. It should be considered an opportunity to drive growth, not only from an economic perspective, but from a social perspective as well. We should not just be looking at bottom line profits, because if we keep looking at that, we will ignore the societal challenges that face us or our children tomorrow. On that note, I would like to ask Dr. Shalamanov, who's here with us today, to give us a Bulgarian perspective of things on how does he see the evolution of legislation in our country, in the Balkans, from this point of view.
Thank you, Ali. It's a privilege to be in this panel, but your challenge is really very high. It's difficult to speak from the point of view of Bulgaria as a whole or the region, but I want to share what we tried to achieve during the last several years. And what we currently have, at least in Bulgaria, is approved by the government strategy, Resilient Bulgaria 2020. It's a pity that Dr. Sharkov was not able to join this panel, who was the one that led the process. I invited him when was for 3 months Minister of Defense in caretaker government, understanding that we don't have time to wait, and it is better to use opportunity to have this draft and to give opportunity through consultations after that to reach agreement between all the stakeholders. The opportunity for us was that it is very high in the agenda of NATO and EU, and it was possible to implement all the recommendations, all the good practices. Practically what Jean-Pierre explained from EU perspective is embedded in this strategy, but with every strategy, most important is implementation. So the principles are quite clear. It is a multi-stakeholder approach that is used. We strongly believe that cybersecurity has to be upfront when you design, when you build the systems. It's important for effectiveness of the systems you to have well-established governance and management system, because for industry, market is driving the innovation, driving the progress, but for the government systems, these are decisions taken between many different stakeholders, and arrangement, including funding, is something to be very clear. For efficiency, we believe that IT has to be organized on the service base, and security is a service as well, with a certain price tag in order to be able to generate money for this. And last but not least, even for the government, IT systems and cybersecurity has to be customer funded. It means whoever rely on these systems have to be able to contribute financially in order this to work. So, as I said, implementation is not so easy. So now more from the academic perspective, what we try to achieve is to really built a strong culture of chief information officer, chief security officer in all administrations, in order to have someone to lead, someone to be responsible, and to have opportunity between these people coming from different administrations to cooperate. It's important to prove that consolidation is possible, and we believe visible consolidation could happen in academic environment through well-arranged funding of the research and development and synchronizing this with EU and NATO capacity in this area. And last but not least, we believe that further steps could be taken only in the framework of what is going on in European Union and NATO, and it is providing a framework for the development. I want to finish with this, that of course in implementation we already recognized that certain sectors are far ahead. Banking sector is excellent example when it comes to implementing cyber security strategies, traffic management service, revenue service. So most important is we to have a platform for information sharing, for cooperation, in order to really follow the trends, really inject the results of research and development, but to be able to learn from industry, to be able to learn from sectors that are ahead of government, in order not to permit any gap between the government and industry, and to use academic platform to maintain this.
Thank you, Valizar. I'll turn to Georgi Dimitrov here. The legal community is one of the pillars, one of the stakeholders of this issue going forward. There's a lot of different pieces of legislation floating around, just like Jean-Pierre mentioned. Then, of course, there's Resilient Bulgaria, the academic community. The legal community advises both the public sector and the corporate sector. How do you view this key issue of cyber fraud, cyber criminalism, cybersecurity and legislation, and how does the legal community think that they will play a part of this in the future?
Thank you. The issues are so interesting, and especially when they're about to be commented from a lawyer, it's a bit risky that I will take all the time.
Because lawyers, I'll stop
lawyers like to speak, you know, when they see the audience. But I'll try to be as brief as possible. Actually, when looking of what the laws are meant to, they're meant to regulate in a long-term relations in the society, in the long term. With the development of the technology, with emerging new technology, it happens that while the government identifies, the governments identify the need to amend laws so that they can regulate and have protection of the legal interests of people in the society. Till that time, the technology has already evolved, and such regulation is already necessary. So this is very, very different, difficult for the society to catch up and to regulate relations which emerge from the digital world, because many the technologies are developing very quickly. This is first. Second, new realms appear into life which were not present before the technologies. Things like domains, like blockchain, you know, like cloud, like there are new things that are coming up, and the law cannot catch up. This is first, and it's a huge problem when speaking about security. The second big issue is that when law comes to regulate relations, the legal system should organize a model to protect the legal interests of people, rights and legal interests. Whole legal system should do that, from lawyers till judges to prosecutors, investigators, everyone. And applying laws in the digital world requires lots of knowledge. And this is one of the great issues now that everyone recognizes that even the law and the legal profession should evolve, so that lawyers should be trained how to deal with these new realms. They don't have the knowledge, or they will have the enough knowledge. So this the education should start from high schools, even not from universities, but from schools.
Yeah.
So speaking about cybersecurity, things should start and be learned even in the kindergarten. Kids should know what is a security, how to protect themselves, what is good, what is bad, I mean things like that, which of course is a huge issue, huge problem, but I will not elaborate much about that. What I'm about to say that recently the laws has evolved much, a lot, and nowadays we are facing quite new laws that are now about to come into force, which particularly deal with cybersecurity, particularly. A bunch of laws. One of them is, for example, the so-called NIS directive, which brings legal requirements for everyone, every legal person in the society, every law, every firm, government institutions, everyone. I mean, to have a special requirements when there is a threat, when there is some kind of vulnerability issue, to report, and there should be a special person to deal with it in the every single organization. So laws now intervene so that they can protect the information in the society by making more and more legal requirements for the legal subjects. So these are lots of requirements. More and more laws intervene into how the technologies are developed, specific requirements, specific standards to be followed by law. For example, if you take the e-government sector, we have a whole bunch of laws that impose obligations on how one information system should be designed, how it should operate in order to be interoperable and to keep a given level of information security. So these are more and more the law how invades into the digital world by imposing requirements, specific requirements with respect to technologies. And second, when it regulates the relation of people with respect to these new realms. So cybersecurity, I think that the laws are still not well developed in a way that they can keep up with all the trends that are now present. But still something is done. Many things are about to happen next year when the NIS directive will enter into force, when GDPR will enter into force, well, the new bunch of directives are about to be implemented. When, in fact, the new ADAS regulation will be, in full force, will be distributed. So practically, there are many things that are now challenging for everyone, from lawyers to IT specialists to businesses. So, of course, this is a very good time for lawyers. but still, these are very challenging time for lawyers because they should learn more about technologies and how they work in order to be effective in protecting the laws and interests in the society.
Thank you very much. I'll ask Vladan a question here because Vladan is a cybersecurity professional. He not only works in our region in the Western Balkans, but as I understand, he does a lot of work in the Asia Pacific as well. We obviously can see that it's a multilateral problem, which affects the public sector, the ordinary user, it affects businesses, it affects the legal community. What are you seeing in the normal course of your work in various countries? What are you seeing from the perspective of a cybersecurity professional and the attitude of the corporate world towards these issues?
Yeah. Quite a good question, definitely. First, I will start with legal aspect of that one. The challenge with legal aspect and trying to resolve things through the legal systems is, I would say, effortless today. Why is that? Because criminals will always use the weakest chain in that legal system to perform the attack. I can give you practical examples. So nowadays, most of the attacks are coming from Africa. Why Africa? Because it's very hard legally to achieve anything there. So at the beginning they were using some other countries, now they're shifting to Africa, and tomorrow they will shift to some other country which has the least legal regulations regarding to that one. Regarding your question about splitting about the target areas, it is very interesting what happened this year. So in the past what you had was the major percentage of all the attacks were against government organizations, industrial sectors, and some other sectors on that one. Today was the very first year when the organized crime addressed also the physical persons as a target as well. And they are starting to reach more money from this area than from industrial sector than it was before. Very interesting moment in time that we should think about. And also where I see the major difference now is in the beginning the hackers were, how say, high-level technology-educated personas with, it was just interesting for them to do some things. They had some benefit and that's it. Now we have really organized crime, which will pull the really good technology experts from countries. For example, today we have the major hackers coming from Ukraine. Why Ukraine? Ukraine is now at very bad economical situation. There are a lot of really clever guys doing technical, with great technical skills. They are hiring them, using them as a tool for performing different kind of attacks, and then they are making profit from this organization. This is very interesting. For your information, this is unofficial information. In Asia Pacific region, in May, we had a breach of around four banks. Each of them lost around 3 to 5 million during this attack. So just for you to get a feeling about the level of challenges and yeah, level of problem we are facing.
Thank you. Philip.
Hi.
Philip comes from obviously a banking sector, one of the most regulated sectors in the world and in Bulgaria. And we can see that there's a lot of regulation now coming forth, whether that's the GDPR or the Payment Services Directive or the fourth AML Directive. All of this impacts not only your operations, but also your requirements for cybersecurity. How do you, from the industry's perspective, from a banking perspective, from a highly regulated environment perspective, how do you see things from your internal perspective, and how do you foresee things going forward?
Thank you, Ali. I will start from a little bit different point of view. And in a nutshell, cybersecurity is too important to be left to be managed by cybersecurity professionals. And quite frankly, I really liked one of the closing slides of the presentation about what's happening at European European Union level, because for us, cybersecurity is yesterday. IT security is day before, not year before yesterday. Now it's about human security. And speaking of which, today on the media there is some fraud that happened in Bull Bank for almost 4 million leva. Why so? Because our security is one of the best in the industry at the level of the European Union. It's so perfect that people don't like using it. And that's a problem. Clients hate using it. And that's a problem. The more we complicate the technological part, the more we increase the operational risk. Well, thank you for that. And I would like to say something. Cybersecurity is 5% of our operational risk. The problem is that it is boosting the operational risk on a double-digit level every year. We can bring down websites as much as we want, but when clients stop using our secure channels and go email, a single fraud is into the million euro level. And there goes, I see two questions. What is the role of startups in the cybersecurity sector? Sorry guys, zero. You can help a little bit with the front end, with user experience, but that's about it. And law, the more we complicated the legal framework and the more we complicated the technological framework, we are increasing the overall operational risk in twofold. How many of you have read more than 10 pages of an article in the last week? Okay, two. Do you know what is the amount of 10-page articles, and we can call them internal regulations, that the modern bank should update every year and this to be read by all the employees in the bank. Make a guess. 647. Okay. Is it manageable? Is it sustainable? We can increase the regulation, but we should actually simplify the regulation.
Yes.
We should not leave the security to the security guys. I was totally mesmerized by the hacking presentation with which the panel started. That's the proof why clients hate it. And I'm not saying it with bad attitude. I'm saying that we must make the security humane and understandable by the end users. Otherwise, we are going in totally different direction. And that's about it. Sorry for the spirited wording.
I think I have a slightly different view on this, and I know that we're running out of time, and I'm sure everybody would like to say a few things on the last comment that I make. I think we've heard from different aspects of this issue. And the one thing that I like what Philip said is that it is not just the problem of the cybersecurity professional or the IT guy. As far as the startups are concerned, my view is everybody has a role. For years, I have been talking about compliance, security threats, fraud threats to businesses, to governments, to public sectors and whatever. And what I say is that it is everybody's job. I think there is not enough discussions being done. I totally understand the background that Philip comes from and the immense amount of work that the banks and the financial sector have to put in to make themselves secure. But the fact of the matter is that the nature of the threat, the face of the threat, the face of the criminal is changing on a daily basis, and it's changing too fast for us to catch up, whether it's legislators or banks or lawyers or the EU. So what I say to startups and what I say to everybody present here is that what we should be thinking of is simplified platforms of discussion with each other. I think there is too much disconnect between the academia, between the professionals, between the lawyers, between the corporate world and the legislators that we cannot actually bring them together onto one platform. So this is one message that I wish to leave everybody with and to start thinking for our joint future is togetherness and working together. I would invite all of the speakers here sitting with me to say something about that. Dr. Shalmanov, do you want to say something?
Yeah, if we go to discuss cybersecurity deeper, of course, at least for now, military are far ahead. There are cyber commands in many nations. They fully recognize that it is not technology only, but it is a network behind. And if you want to succeed, you have to be able to defeat the network. On the other side, you have to be good in preparing your people. But we need the balance, because we cannot go after models of cyber defense and cyber security that is designed for military systems when it comes to our everyday life. We cannot go after what the banking sector is developing for their systems. So this agreement, what is enough and what is the risk and who is responsible for the risk, and we to be prepared to manage this risk at personal level is really
Thank
very
you.
Important.
John, do you want to?
Yeah, well, I'd like to react to some of the things that were said, which found me quite in agreement, I have to say. So cybersecurity cannot be taken in isolation, nor can it be cut it in small pieces. And it's actually a very complex problem, which is itself immersed in a much bigger problems of digital transformation and resilience of our society as a whole, and perhaps mankind. And you mentioned fragmentations or the fact that we should work together. This is what I try to refer with fragmentation. We really need to talk with each other much more, understand much more, probably to simplify things. But I want to react with respect to legislation. You said legislation is a threat. That is something I don't like, or you cited somebody saying that. That is something that I don't like. I cannot accept that legislation, which is basically the way we decide to work together in our society, in our democratic nation, can be seen as a threat. It is a basis of our society. What is no good is Byzantine legislation, or ill-fetched complex legislation, or too much mandatory top-down legislation. There are hard, there are soft legislation, and indeed this legislation should not be too much anchored on technology per se. They should be based on principles that would help
the lawyers, because they like principles. And then these principles can be enforced by technology as time flies, and technology can change, and standards can change, or perhaps best available techniques in order to reach some high-level goals in terms of legal principles can be achieved differently over the time. So I'm much more inclined for this type of legislation than pure technical legislation, which in my opinion I've always failed. Then you mentioned about technologies and entrepreneurships and startups, etc. Everybody is driven to exploit technology, etc., to do business, and there is an issue with that, an ethical issue. And indeed, I think there is an ethical issue connected to the things about humanity versus technology. And I think that the new generation which are creating this spin-off and this technology, they have, of course, a responsibility to harness the power of technology for making some money, for bringing wealth to their own company, to their society, to their family, but they have also responsibility for how they implement this technology for the future of our world. They are building our future, the future of their children, the future of my grandchildren, okay? And this is something that despite this competitiveness which is there in the field, you need to take into account to build into your products and services values. Absolutely. Because eventually these values will be paid by your customers. Nobody come and buy your product or your services because you are an incredibly efficient company. I want your product because you are efficient or because you have an excellent business continuity plan. No, they build your product because they trust you, because they know your values, because you sell something that appeals to you from a human perspective. And that is the type of thing you need to reach in developing your business case and applying your technology.
Thank you, John. Obviously, we don't have enough time to exploit the depth of information we have in the panel speakers.
I would like to add one thing. I think I can help a lot I fully agree with Mr. Jean-Pierre. I think we should simplify the problem and we can see the resolution. How we today regulate, for example, that this phone will not start a fire in this building. There are specific regulations that this phone must full in order to be sold. Also about this building, do we have regulations which are saying what about the fire alarms, what about different set of controls? The same thing must be applied to cyber world as well. You cannot sell the application or IoT device, which is, I don't know, $30, which can make harm to its own owners. So we can just use the same principles we apply to the cyber world, and most of the things, not all, but most of the things will be resolved by that. I fully agree that it must not be complex, because if it is complex, we are lost and we cannot apply that.
I'll just close by saying that I'm a big believer of integrity and ethics, something which we are losing as we go along the corporate path. We're too focused on profits. We've lost the sense of the human touch. The integrity of people, I think that should be brought back into the business, into the business agenda. And I think one path is to bring good legislation, which is being discussed amongst all the stakeholders, to simplify it and to make it more ethical for all of us. Thank you very much for joining us here today. And I hope that we can keep discussing this topic amongst each other. Thank you.
Thank you.
Gentlemen, thank you for the discussion. Нещо, което ми направи впечатление днес в думите на почти всеки един от панелистите и keynote спикерите, беше, че повечето хора говореха за сътрудничество. Било то комуникация между държава и институции, и стартъп компании, било то между неправителствени организации и стартъп компании, policy makers и стартъп компании и така нататък. И всъщност ние осъзнаваме, че това е една доста съществена част, кооперацията и колаборацията, за да може всичко да се развива напред и да има реален резултат от това, което правим. В EDIT сме помислили и за това. И всъщност една от
Идеята и целите на конференцията днес е всъщност да положи едни основи на сътрудничество по основните теми, дигитални теми, които ние бихме дефинирали като предприемачество, киберсигурност и ролята на жените в технологиите. Така че да имаме една добра основа, на база на която Балканите и партньорските организации на Балканите да могат да сътрудничат и да създават още по-добри и смислени неща за всички нас. Затова инициирахме едно по-дългосрочно партньорство и едно споразумение, под което представителите на регионалните екосистеми ще сложат подписа си след малко. Сега бих искал да поканя Саша, за да ни разкаже повече и всъщност да видим какво следва. Аплодисменти за Саша.
Със сигурност вярвам всички споделяме разбирането, че в дигитално свързания свят, във времето, в което няма граници за бизнеса и няма ограничения за идеите, има обаче нужда от не просто това ни е виртуално да обменяме, но и да се познаваме, да имаме формалните връзки и интелекта на различните е необходим. Затова решихме да поканим нашите партньори от държавите от Западните Балкани, които имахме възможност днес също да срещнем. За това да направим едно панбалканско споразумение. То е инициатива на която тръгва отдолу. Аз лично много вярвам в това, че устойчивите инициативи се случват, когато експертите, хората, които ги носят, които познават средата, са техни двигатели. Затова и решихме да положим основата на една отворена мрежа, към която, разбира се, вярваме, че много от експертите, професионалистите ще се присъединят. И заедно с приятелите от близките до нас съседни държави да положим формално и официално началото на партньорство в трите сектора, за които Никола каза, в края на днешния позатворен и пълен с много различни обменени идеи, информация ден. Защо избрахме три големи сектора за такъв тип сътрудничество? Безспорно обмена и създаването на ефективни мрежи, които да подкрепят иновативната дигитална икономика, стартиращите компании, експертите, създаване на среда, в която отвъд националните граници хора, които имат общи идеи и обща страст в дадена тема, могат да колаборират, да обменят, да създават общи компании, да развиват общи идеи, е от ключово значение и всъщност тя беше и централната тема на днешната ни конференция. За това как стартиращите компании, носителите на заряда, за това да трансформираме портрета на икономическата среда в България, на Балканите, в Европа, могат още по-ефективно да работят в мрежа. Втората тема, тя също беше спомената няколко пъти от различни от участниците. Времето ни изисква всички ресурси, изисква интелекта, таланта на всеки, който може да допринесе с експертизата си в решение за дигиталния трансформиращ се свят. Ролята на жените от ключово значение. Ние, Бulgaria е лидер по отношение на жени в ИКТ индустрията. Статистиката обаче сочи, че тая лидерска позиция проектирана в стартъп екосистемата води до съотношението, до водещата фигура, че 12% от стартъпите са водени от жени. Има много работа в това отношение. Ние работим повече от 5 години, затова повече жени да избират инженерни професии, работа в науката, да заемат лидерски роли. Имаме специален формат Entrepreneur, който да стимулира момичета от ранна възраст да избират за себе си предприемачески път на развитие. И бихме искали заедно с подобен тип инициативи на Балканите ние да постигнем синергии, да постигнем обмен, да постигнем това, което по моя от моя личен опит е най-важно, да окуражим жените да мислят за себе си отвъд рамките, които сами си поставят в професията. Тъй, че втората ни тема и територия за партньорство са жените в технологиите. Както споменах и комисар Габриел, много се радвам, че тя подкрепи инициативата ни. През април ние планираме специален форум, който ще бъде female dominated, така че разбира се, то е отворен за всички, които подкрепят идеята. Третата територия, в която с приятелите от лидери на балканските дигитални екосистеми така се съгласихме да развиваме киберсигурност. Тя е важна с всички аргументи, които се чуха в последния панел, но също и защото ни се иска да обединим усилия и да работим заедно по две направления. Едното, какви технологични решения могат инженерният талант в колаборация да създава. И второто, разбира се, какви са практическите измерения на това да сътрудничим по отношение на фалшиви новини, по отношение на киберхигиена като една обща среда в държавите ни и възможности за обмен на такъв тип практики. Тъй, че с голямо удоволствие в края на днешния форум бих искала да поканя Иво Шпигел, Григорис Цацикостас, Веле Самък, Милош Лазович и Владан Тодорович. Please take a seat. It is just informal. There is a mic if you want to share some view. Може ли един микрофон, който виждам на... Един микрофон искам да донеса. Окей.
Заповядайте. Саша, за теб също. There you go.
So, do you want to share something or missing? No? Not anymore. Someone you want to share, not me to speak or no? Yeah. And general comments.
Well, the gentleman who was moderating the previous panel mentioned the word togetherness.
Yeah.
So, you know, I inherited some old vinyl records from my parents, who are still alive, thank God, but they're not part of my collection. And there is some records by Harry Belafonte in that collection, and he has one concert, and he's singing at the concert. He has this declaration. He says, "Togetherness, there is goodness in it." Yeah. But on that note, you know, any activity that can contribute to better pan-European integration and collaboration is absolutely essential. So, generally, I mean, on that note, I'd say congratulations on the initiative, and you know, very happy to take part in the future activities to better coordinate and communicate between our ecosystems.
Yeah, thank you for supporting the initiative that just came in a natural way. I would say this is a natural step, and I'm pretty sure that there is a lot to be done. What we are planning as a next step is in March to meet again in a bigger group and to be able to discuss very practical steps on what we have achieved for these 4 months, but also what we agree to do in the future.
I fully agree. I have to share.
Hi, you have a mic.
Okay. Doesn't matter. Yes, yeah. Thank you. So also, Sasha, it is really my pleasure for your initiative here. And I have to say that it was my dream of establishing this kind of Pan-Balkan cooperation, really. And I was totally surprised when I realized about this program. So thank you very much for your effort and for your help for achieving this.
Okay. So. You will... Well, like everybody else, I want to thank you for having us here and for your initiative. I also want to say to the wider audience here, I mean, I cannot share my business card with everybody, obviously. If you're interested in anything that's happening in Serbia and Bosnia or even Albania and Macedonia, please reach out and we can connect and share, and not just officially like this, but also unofficially. Sure. So, yeah, and thanks for the initiative once again.
Okay. You wanna...
Well, if we decompose the word ecosystem, it practically means people who want to work together and do great stuff together. And I think that this is a beginning. And since Ivo started with retro arts, I will go with my favorite music, movie, Casablanca, that finishes like, this is the beginning of a beautiful friendship.
So I don't think there's much more for me to add. So it just leaves a lot of work for us, so, which okay. is a good initiative.
Okay. It's the beginning of a work in front of us.
More work.
Okay. So we should have organized a protocol to exchange. So let's have a system to exchange, exactly. Somebody to help, to bring, someone to da nosiš, da nosiš, we bring it. Commission always helps, yeah. Okay, no, this was good. Моля те, помогни да го ротираш. We should have training to make it with one step.
I think next time should be digital.
Really good point. Fully agree.
We'll copy it with digital, but to have just also. Моля те, подавай ги на там да ги потишите. Yeah, and of course. The historical pen. I think that yeah.
This one?
I think this is all right.
Yes. Yeah, everybody, let me take this one too. Yeah.
We share with the rest of the
members. I think everybody keep ones, and everybody. One is here.
Also?
Yeah. And this one is yours, Bella. Okay, so. Now is the moment for a photo,
okay.
A formal one. So, excellent. Guys, thank you very much for the trust and for supporting this initiative. I'm pretty sure that we are starting something that will have a strong impact on the economy of the region and of importance of the region as whole on European level. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah.
as Miloš said, regarding his help regarding the ecosystems and startups, also I can offer my help regarding cybersecurity if you need someone to be hacked or you want to be protected.
The price list was shown.
Real one is much more expensive, trust me, these are the amateurs. It doesn't matter, free of charge help really about cybersecurity, you will find at LinkedIn contact and I will be glad to help anyone.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. And pleasure.
Едни последни думи преди да си тръгнем. Всъщност, Саша, ако ти искаш да...
Ти си да поканим екипа да се снима.
Добре. Окей.
Maybe I wanna say... аз искам да кажа няколко думи преди да тръгнем. Искам специално да благодаря на екипа на MOVE.BG, който подготви тази конференция. За това, което днес преживяхте, стои изключително много работа. Това беше комплексно събитие. Предполагам, ще се съгласите с мене. Програмата беше като за 4 конференции. И избрахме да поемем този организационен и тематичен риск, защото искахме да дадем икономическия прочит на българското председателство, наред с това, което ние всъщност правим вече година и половина за подкрепа на българската дигитална стартъп екосистема. Ще видим какъв е реално резултата, но това, което аз лично получих като сигнал, като коментар от комисар Габриел, от Мат Бритин, от много ценните участници от Европейската комисия, от доста от българските представители, е, че ние постигнахме целта ни да дигнем летвата и да поставим разговора на европейско ниво за качеството и възможностите на българската стартъп екосистема. Така че аз искам да помоля всички да аплодираме екипа на MOVE.BG. Искам да ви покана всички, за да се снимаме ние този път, защото винаги не остава време за това. Сърдечно ви благодаря.
Аз през това време, докато екипа на Edit се събира, държа да благодарим и на всички панелисти, на всички лектори, на модераторите и отново на екипа на Edit, че всъщност дадоха от енергията си, дадоха от това, което имат в себе си и това, което гори в тях, за да създадат едно такова събитие. Надявам се да ви е било приятно, надявам се и аз като водещ да съм допринесъл за това нещо. И се надявам скоро да се видим отново. Жани, всеки друг, който се чувства от екипа, може
Иво,
да се
къде е? Не, не. Иво не... може ли Иво и Тонката да викнем от терасата?
Ако са там, да.
Да. И Елисар също. Ела. Билянка, Елисар и още двама кавалери чакаме.
Аз това, през това време да си кажа, ако стартъп разговорите днес не са ми били достатъчни, тази вечер нашите партньори от Table правят за първи път в България финалното събитие по раздаване на Central European Startup Awards в София Tech Park. Всички сте добре дошли, така че дори повече от нас се отправят сега натам. Заповядайте, те са много готини, пълни с енергия, като нас и като вас. Така че заповядайте.
Айде, още двама. Да. Иво?
Добре.
Да.
Нещо? Нещо. Не са заключен, не е заключен. Не е заключен отпред на снимката.
Добре, че не го казваш на микрофон.
Добре, че съм с микрофон на всички снимки. Може ли още една без микрофона?
Аз съм с микрофон. В смисъл. Аз
че...
Не, ми е готово.
Супер, мерси.
Абсолютно най-хубаво става. Да.
Чудесно.
Браво.
Благодарим ви много, че бяхте с нас. Лека вечер.
За никой веднъж ще не поразмете.
Global connectivity and digital technologies change the paradigms on which we build our world. Today, knowledge is available online to everyone, and our collective intelligence is doubling every day online. 360 million Europeans use the internet every day to study, work, shop, and sell. Digital technologies offer many opportunities such as better manufacturing, communication, transportation, education and healthcare. Together, we can accelerate this process. To make this possible, we need to constantly keep an eye on the latest developments and collect data. So, we started here. Where is Bulgaria on the European digital map? The Open Network EDIT takes care of this. Together with local organizations interested in supporting the digital development of the region, we conduct an annual study on Bulgaria's most vital micro, small and startup digital companies. We asked 215 of them about their businesses, technologies they develop and their impact. Now, Bulgaria has a long tradition in the ICT, both hardware manufacturing and software programming. But never before has Bulgaria experienced such a development of the digital industry as in the recent 5 years. Bulgarian engineers are building technology solutions for the tomorrow's world. Today there are 10 cities in Bulgaria with strong IT communities. We have 2 cities completely covered with low energy sensor mobile networks and a community of blockchain experimenters. Today Bulgaria is getting more and more advanced in software development and platform building. Our great minds are currently working on cloud computing, APIs, machine learning, big data analysis, connectivity and many others. 78% of them provide services and products for the EU market. Some of our most successful digital companies transform global industries such as aviation, logistics, entertainment, financial analysis, insurance and everyday business processes for companies across sectors. More than one-third of those digital companies see themselves as innovators. 13% have registered patents. We believe that by connecting the dots and ecosystems in the EU, we can all benefit from the shared technologies and talent. Southeastern Europe plays a crucial role in this. We want to build on that foundation and connect the great minds and innovative businesses across the whole Union. So all digital hubs in Europe make up the European Digital Hub.